stripped away. Am I simply become longing just to breathe something that's a word that will bless your heart? I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of words. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. King of endless world, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours. Every single breath, I'll bring you more than a song. Oh, a song. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you.
I'm coming back.
It's all about you.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. I welcome you for tonight's session, and I do implore you to invite more people to come and journey with us. I know someone would say maybe the time has changed, so people are still maybe like waiting for it. But then, if you are here, then that person too can be here, given you have informed him or her. You see, sometimes people just read what is so recent on the screen. So someone will be like, maybe I've only seen Living Rosary, and someone who can't see the pouring ministry that will be there at exactly 8. So we want to start early and at least have everything done in time. They're like, as the plan that was shared during the course of the day. So I implore all of us, invite more colleagues, to invite more people. You see, sometimes you feel you are so down, you feel you can't do anything good for yourself. You feel everything has maybe like backfired on your life, in your life, and maybe within your family or in the all states of life, and all states of maybe things that you've been in. But there are people that whose life maybe overturned. It's just overturned, and maybe they can't even know what I can maybe compare it to. It's overturned, but it's the Lord that received it in the due course. Have you ever seen maybe like as you throw up the child, and as you are preparing to receive that child in your hands, and the Lord just receives the child before you do? That's what we are going to hear today. There are people whose life was so hard, but really, the Lord just received them. They didn't seek for a conversion, but the Lord saw what they were worth and just called on them, come, I need you. So you too, me and you, today you may be maybe someone who is like, I'm so weak in ministering, I'm so weak in evangelization, but when the Lord has called on you, you just find yourself coming to the way of the Lord. I know it's time for our chaplet, so I do call upon each one of us to get set with our rosaries and we as well invite other people. Don't forget to share the link. Share it with someone. Let someone just miss to come. But when at least you have shared, because that's what is of importance. What is of value is not maybe how you have known the word, but to how many people you have shared it with. Because we all know that St. Paul went through many things. He fought the faith. He fought Jesus Christ. But when he came and received, you will hear of thousands being converted, thousands choosing to follow Christ because of the man who at first fought the ministry. So thank you very much. Let's begin our chaplet in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O God, come to my assistance. O Lord, make haste to help me. Glory be the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, it is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The first salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael, and the celestial choir of Seraphim, may the Lord make us worthy to burn with the fire of perfect charity. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners. Now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The second salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael, the celestial choir of cherubim, may the Lord grant us the grace to leave the ways of sin and run in the path of Christian perfection. Amen. Kitaffe ali mu ggulu, erinnya litiibwe. Obwakabaka bw'obuggye byagala bikolebwe mu nsi ng'ebikolebwa mu ggulu. Otuweerera emmere yaffe eya buli nnaku, otusonyiwa ebibi byaffe nga naffe tusonyiwa abatukola obubi. Totwala mu kukemebwa naye tulokole mu bubi. Amiina. Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema Omukama ali naawe. Waweebwa omukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endayo yaweebwa omukisa. Maria omutuukirivu nnyina wa Katonda, tusabire ffe aboonoonyi, kaakaane mu kaseera ak'okufa kwaffe. Amiina. Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema Omukama ali naawe. Waweebwa omukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endayo yaweebwa omukisa. Maria omutuukirivu nnyina wa Katonda, tusabire ffe aboonoonyi, kaakaane mu kaseera ak'okufa kwaffe. Amiina. Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema Omukama ali naawe. Waweebwa omukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endayo yaweebwa omukisa. Maria omutuukirivu nnyina wa Katonda, tusabire ffe aboonoonyi, kaakaane mu kaseera ak'okufa kwaffe. Amiina. The third salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael and the celestial choir of thorns, may the Lord infuse into our hearts a true and sincere spirit of humility. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us from temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The fourth salutation. By the intercession of St. Michael and the Celestial Choir of Dominations, may the Lord give us the grace to govern our senses and overcome any unruly passions. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thou be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The fifth salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael and Celestial Choir of Virtues, may the Lord preserve us from evil and falling into temptations. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thou be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us from temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The sixth salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael and Celestial Choir of Powers, may the Lord protect our souls against the snares and temptations of the devil. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thou be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us from temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The seventh salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael and Celestial Choir of Principalities, may God fill our souls with a true spirit of obedience. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thou be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The eighth salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael, the celestial choir of archangels, may the Lord give us perseverance in faith and in all good works, in order that we may attain the glory of heaven. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us from temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The ninth salutation, by the intercession of St. Michael and the celestial choir of angels, may the Lord grant us to be protected by them in this mortal life and conducted in the life to come to heaven. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us from temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In honor of St. Michael, the archangel, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In honor of St. Gabriel, the archangel, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In honor of Saint Raphael, the archangel, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In honor of our guardian angels, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thou be thine on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Concluding prayer. O glorious Prince St. Michael, chief and commander of the heavenly hosts, guardian of sorrows, vanquisher of the bowsprits, servant in the house of the divine king, and our admirable conductor, you who shine with excellence and for human virtue. Deliver us from all evil, who turn to you with confidence, and enable us by your gracious protection to serve God more and more faithfully every day. Amen. Pray for us, O glorious Saint Michael, Prince of the Church of Jesus Christ, that we may be made worthy of his promises. Almighty and everlasting God, who by the prodigy of goodness and merciful desire for the salvation of all men, has appointed the most glorious Archangel Saint Michael, Prince of your Church, make us worthy, we ask you, to be delivered from all our enemies, that none of them may harass us at the hour of death, but that we may be conducted by him into your presence. This we ask through the mercy of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The return of Saint Michael, the Archangel. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, hear us. Christ, graciously hear us. God, the Father of heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, the giver of life, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity, one God, have mercy on us. Holy Mary, Queen of Angels, pray for us. Saint Michael, pray for us. Saint Michael, abundant font of divine wisdom, pray for us. Saint Michael, most perfect adorer of the divine word, pray for us. Saint Michael, whom God crowned with honor and glory, pray for us. Saint Michael, most powerful prince of the heavenly host, pray for us. Saint Michael, standard bearer of the most holy Trinity, pray for us. Saint Michael, guardian of paradise, pray for us. Saint Michael, guide and consoler of the people of God, pray for us. Saint Michael, surrender and fortitude of church militant, pray for us. Saint Michael, honor and joy of church triumphant, pray for us. Saint Michael, light of the angels, pray for us. Saint Michael, protection of Orthodox people, pray for us. Saint Michael, strength of those who fight under the standard of the cross, pray for us. Saint Michael, light and hope of souls near death, pray for us. Saint Michael, our most sure aid, pray for us. Saint Michael, our help in our adversities, pray for us. Saint Michael, head of the everlasting judgment, pray for us. Saint Michael, consoler of souls languishing in purgatory, pray for us. Saint Michael, receiver of souls of the elect after death, pray for us. Saint Michael, our prince, pray for us. Saint Michael, our defender, pray for us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, spare us, O Lord. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, graciously hear us, O Lord. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Pray for us, O Saint Michael, the Archangel, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, may your continued blessing sanctify us and grant us through the intercession of Saint Michael the wisdom that teaches us to lay up our treasure in heaven and choose eternal goods over those of this world. You who lives and reigns forever. Amen. Pray at Saint Michael the Archangel. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in the battle of our protection. In the battle, be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do you, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Mary, Queen of the Angels, pray for us. Mary, Queen of the Angels, pray for us. Mary, Queen of the Angels, pray for us. We have prayed and trusted in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's continue sharing the ring. Let us continue inviting other colleagues. We are going now to start the pouring ministry. And I really believe each one of us would at least deserves to listen, deserves to know, deserves to see this conversion, and deserves to see this life after conversion. You see, sometimes there's somewhere where I read that there are many things, like what there's something that the hardest thing that a human being can do is what is conversion. You see, you can give up on each and everything, but convert your soul from that thing to a new person is sometimes hard. You may say, I'm no longer drinking. But as soon as you leave drinking, there is a vice that takes you. Yet you would say, as soon as I've left this habit, let me go back to Christ. So today we are listening about St. Paul, who after the conversion gave his entire life to Christ. What has always inspired me from his quotes is this, where he says, when I was with the drunkards, I looked like a drunkard. When I was with sinners, I behaved like a sinner to win their souls. Brother Moist, I know I'm just taking some of your miss, but it's your day. You are welcome.
Continue for 2 more minutes.
Okay, thank you. So sometimes there are things that really you find in life and you are like, what really will change this from this or to the other? But really, if at all you read through the quotes, read at the verses that Brother Mo shared with us, there are things that really you find in life that at least, however much you have struggled, there is someone who struggled beyond you. Just ask yourself, if Paul had chosen to go and even after seeking even letters to go and torture these people that were trusting in Christ, then along with the way, he loses sight. He's just maybe like he's thrown just like there. Someone would send this one as maybe, I don't know whether they call it of eclipse or something like that. They will say, on a good day, you just fall somewhere. But within that moment, there is a mighty voice you are listening to. There is a mighty voice being whispering to you something. But this voice is a voice of conversion. This is what St. Paul received on that day. We all, at least if at all you fought and you read through today's first reading, you said he was led to Ananias. Today, it could have been Brother Moses who is your Ananias. You might have been so blind. You might have had maybe situations that maybe made you feel you are so maybe disowned by this world, disowned by the community, disowned by the people you believed in. But today, you are going to find joy. Just bear it in mind that today is going to be a different day. You might have maybe attended living rosaries of all kinds, but today there is this ministry, specifically of a person. A person who, out of the letters in the New Testament, out of the 40, you find that 14 were from this one person. I don't know how you really feel. If at all like you are heading a certain campaign, and someone says that out of maybe the 6 chapters we have in our books, out of the 16 chapters, this man or this lady is the one who engineered the 10 of these chapters. You can even move well knowing that the entire concept is yours. And we find that all these people, the rest of the world, like those that really participated in this in the New Testament, some really were with him. And they talked things that they really observed. There are many things that today we find in life. Sometimes we find in communities. Sometimes we find at the work or the workplaces. But when there's a day when someone was asking me that, okay, what's wrong? When do you feel that it's a moment to say that I've given up? I know each one of us have ever been in a state where you find it's a moment to give up. But is it giving up on sin? I don't know what you really felt like it was a moment to give up. But today we are going to hear. Today we are going to hear something. Really, every time I really feel, every time I, for some of us, right, like in the Bible school or Bible study or OLSG Bible study, I know you might have felt this. The previous weekend has been a weekend about Paul. And today, from nowhere we hear, it's a day of conversion, Paul's conversion. In all the feast in the entire church, there's no anyone's conversion that we celebrate. They're like as birthdays. There are only three birthdays in the entire church that are celebrated. The rest are days that these saints died. But today we have a conversion. Why don't you at least as well take this conversion? Is it bad? I don't believe we can take it. Brother Moses, let me hand over to you and you start.
Let us share the advert on the screen. Let us share the screen of the advert for the talk. Thank you. Doreen? Thank you, dear Jesus. 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 So I want to welcome all of you for our special program tonight as we look at the life of Saint Paul. And I encourage you to invite your family members, invite your friends, invite everybody. Invite everybody. We are just beginning shortly. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. So I'm somewhere. I'm not home, but I will be going home after. Yep. So I'll try to have some maximum light where I am. And we go through this together. So I want to welcome you once again and also thank Brother Dale for taking us through the chaplet of St. Michael. And you that are here, you are blessed. And I pray that the Lord's will may be fulfilled in your life. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to come and lead us. Let us ask the Holy Spirit to come and guide us. If you have not shared this advert that is on the screen, you can share it now to your friends and invite them. We are beginning right away. And after the program, after the lecture on St. Paul, we shall immediately go into the Seven Sorrows Rosary with Evelyn. And I think I should be done by 9 p.m. By 9 p.m. So if you have not shared it, it's on WhatsApp. You may take a screenshot and share, but the screenshot changes the original clarity and the original fineness of the advert, of the flyer. When you take a screenshot, it changes many things. So you can check it from your WhatsApp. It has been shared on all platforms where you are, as long as you're in OLSG. You can get it and share it across. And when you do that, it is paying homage. Some of you, I was with you some time back, maybe like a few years ago, when we were talking about paying homage to a saint. Amen. So even sharing this advert on such a big day, you are paying homage to St. Paul. There's an honor you are giving him and he will pay you. He will reward you. Amen. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Jesus. He will reward you for that. Amen. St. Paul will reward you for that. The Lord will reward you as well for that. Amen. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. So I'm trying to get maximum light here. Okay. Thank you, Jesus. So there we go. Amen. So whatever you do, whatever you work at, that's one of the quotations that were given in the morning. One of St. Paul's quotations, very special quotation that I want you to know today and take and receive and take it as yours. Colossians, let's open Colossians, one of the classical Pauline letters. One of the classical Pauline letters, letters to Colossians, chapter 3, and from verse 23 to 24. Kindly get a pen and a paper, write these verses down. And as you write them down, some of you are going to catch fire for the love of St. Paul tonight. Amen. Some of you are going to catch fire. Brother Morris, I'm not getting your voice. Shwari, who is this? Motes Susan? Are you for real? People, am I not audible really? Am I not audible? Am I audible? Am I heard? Motes Susan, you are saying you're not getting my voice. It's your network. I don't know. Maybe others can let me know. Is it my network or her network? You are audible and very clear. Amen. So I was saying you need to get a pen and a paper, or you'll be screenshotting the verses that we shall share as we talk about this very special apostle, this very big man of God that is such a living example for us all. So share the link. And when you do the work of God, he gives us a few verses, St. Paul gives us a few verses to give you courage, to give you motivation to work for the Lord. Amen. And I'm going to share them right away. So I will mix up many things, but all will be towards St. Paul so that we can get the best out of this. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. So you are somebody. You want to receive the grace. You are somebody. You want to receive the grace to fall in love with the work of God. You want to receive the fire of ministry. And ministry can vary from different degrees. Amen. Ministry doesn't have to be, you don't have to be an Evelyn to come and preach here every day. You don't have to be a Dale to come and lead. No, ministry can vary. Amen. That is why another verse Paul gives us, Romans 12, verse 12. Give it to us. Romans 12, verse 12. He implores us to be humble and to accept even humble duties. Romans 12, verse 12. Romans 12 and verse 12. Romans, let's get 16, please. 16, let's read 16. Romans 12, 16. And this is a classical Pauline quotation. Wow. Thank you, St. Paul, for today. Thank you that today we have been celebrating your conversion. We know that we are also on our conversion journeys. We are in journeys of our conversion. We are sometimes we are okay. Sometimes we fall. Sometimes we rise. Sometimes we are in darkness. Sometimes we are in the light. But for you, when you got converted, oh dear St. Paul, you never looked back. The moment you got converted, you never looked back. We pray for the grace tonight, for me and for you who are here. And St. Paul tells us in Romans 3:23, this is another Pauline quotation, Romans 3, verse 23. He says that all of us have sinned, and because of that, we have lost the glory of God. Everyone, St. Paul says, has sinned, including himself. That's what he says. Everybody has sinned. All of us have sinned. And because of that, we are far away from God's saving presence. So, St. Paul, we have sinned. We have sinned and we sin every day. And we are struggling to come out of our sins. We are struggling to come out of our sins every day. And like you struggled as well. And somewhere we are told of the struggle of St. Paul to come out of sin. And for that one, I'm going to give a free Bible. Somewhere we are told of the struggle by St. Paul to come out of sin. St. Paul tells us somewhere in one of his letters. Amen? In one of his letters, he tells us, I am also struggling to come out of my sins. Where is that? Somebody raise your hand. Tell us where it is. I will give you a free Bible for that. Where is that? Raise your hand, please. We don't want to waste time. Somebody knows? Raise your hand. Paul is saying, I'm struggling. I want to come out of these bad things. The bad things I don't want to do, I end up doing them. And the good things I don't want to do, please don't Google. Don't be like Sapphira and Ananias. Don't be like Sapphira and Ananias who tried to cheat Peter. They thought they were cheating Peter, Acts of the Apostles chapter 5. They thought they were cheating Peter, but they were cheating God. So don't Google, please. Let us put to test our Bible knowledge. Amen? Let us put to test our Bible knowledge. And
If it is lacking, we ask St. Paul. Amen. I remember years back then, many years ago, when I was really struggling in my journey in the Bible, in the Bible knowledge, Mother Mary led me to St. Paul. And he told me, please go to my son, Paul. Amen. That's what Mother Mary told me. She said, go to my son, Paul. He's going to help you. And that is when my devotion to St. Paul started. And I got inflamed with the love of St. Paul. And when my time came to have my wife, start a family, Mother Mary gave me a lady who is also called after Paul, Paula. And that was a confirmation that Mother Mary wants me to be in love with one of his faithful disciples. One of the most faithful disciples of his son. Amen? You can write this in the message. St. Paul was one of the most faithful disciples of his son, of the son of Mary, our Lord Jesus Christ. And I know Mother Mary is very proud of Paul. And if you read the book, The Mystical City of God, The Mystical City of God, written by a Spanish nun who got many visions about Mother Mary, somewhere we are told about the conversion of Paul. And the conversion of Paul was achieved through two holy souls. It was achieved through ceaseless intercessions of two people. One of them was St. Stephen, one of the first seven deacons of the church, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 6 and chapter 7. One of the first deacons of the church. And to the greatest extent, Mother Mary. Maybe I will talk about it later on. Amen. So Paul was one of the most faithful disciples of Jesus, the son of Mary, our mother. So Mother Mary loved him so very much. Amen. So St. Paul tells us that even him, he struggles. He was saying, he says, I'm struggling. The good things I want to do, I end up not doing them. And then the bad things I wouldn't want to do in my life, I end up doing them every day. Maybe this is the summer of your life. Maybe this is the summer of my life as I talk right now. As you listen, it's a summer of your life. It is called failure to understand your own actions. I know it is called, I do not understand my own actions. The summer of all this is called, I do not understand my own actions. So one time Paul said, I do not understand my own actions. So that's why we are praying as we begin this lecture. Not only just listening and being excited, but receive the grace that is ours in Jesus. St. Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. 2 Corinthians. This is also another Pauline classic. Pauline classic. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. Let's look at it. What does he say? He says, but his answer was, my grace is all you need. I need a version which says the grace of the Lord is sufficient for us. The grace of the Lord is sufficient for us. That is also another Pauline classic. God's grace is always sufficient for me. So my dear brother, my dear sister, in your weakness, even as you are attaining the living rosary every day, just to know that the grace of the Lord will always be there for you. The grace of the Lord is sufficient for me. My grace is sufficient for you. So one time Paul was weak also. Like I'm going to ask Irene, I saw her raising her hand. Paul was weak, troubled by many things, falling and rising. And then he asked God, what can I do? Bible tells us in verse 7, he prayed in verse 8. He prayed three times. Three times, not that he prayed three times to come out of his weaknesses. He prayed many times. And he said, verse 8 and 9 and 10. Highlight them for us, please. Verse 8, 9 and 10. So he prayed, he said, three times, St. Paul says, I pleaded to the Lord to take away this pain. Three times I pleaded to the Lord to take away this weakness. Maybe as I'm here and as you are there, there is a weakness that for which you are pleading to the Lord. There is a weakness in me. There is a weakness in you that is blocking the blessings of God from coming to you. There is a weakness in me and in you. And sometimes these weaknesses can be social weaknesses whereby every member of your family is undergoing through the same weakness. Today, I've just been meeting a lady. That's why I'm late in town. I was meeting a lady in counseling here at Christ the King. I'm actually at Christ the King. And she was telling me, Brother Morris, whatever I try, whatever I intend to do, nothing fails. I mean, nothing works. Everything I ever do fails completely. And then she told me how she had many near missed opportunities. almost she's breaking through, then nothing happens. She's connected somewhere. Somebody, she's well aware that this person is going to give me a job. I'm going to break through this person. But at the 11th hour, the pot is broken. I don't know how many times your pot has been broken. You know, in Runyankore, we have an adage whereby somebody goes and fetches water on the pot, because before then there were no jerrycans. So you fetch the water from the well many kilometers down, and then you carry the pot on your head. That's what it used to be before the jerrycan, before the tap water. And then you carry the pot on the head full of water. Then if a misfortune was to come, immediately you are stepping on the doorway, crossing over. Remember the olden times, those of you who grew up in the village, there is a way they would make a house, and then the place where you would cross over to the house, where the door is, they would raise it a bit so that the floods cannot enter the house. So Okote Rotan, Otambuka, you would make like a leap to get inside. And most times, whenever people would be making leaps, that is when they would lose balance and the pot falls. And the water is off. So maybe, I don't know how many times your pot has broken when you're almost there. So this lady was telling me, I was almost there on this occasion, and nothing happened. And as she was telling me, the Lord inspired me to ask her, I saw a vision, and the Lord was saying, asked me, is there any member of your family that is doing witchcraft? Is there any member of your family that is doing idolatry? And later on, we came to know that many people in our family are doing idolatry. And that was the block. That was the block to our progress. I don't know what is blocking you, my dear brother, my dear sister. Now, I don't know how many times you have prayed to the Lord, but Paul tells us, three times I prayed to the Lord. Three times I pleaded to the Lord to take away this situation from me, to take away this weakness from me. Amen? I don't know what weakness you are praying about, but then the Lord gave an answer, and the Lord said, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in your weakness. For power is made perfect in your weakness. Then Paul came to know, oh, you mean when I am weak, that is when I am strong? My dear brothers, my dear sisters, I want to tell you today, as you are attending this memorial lecture on St. Paul, that it is at your weakest point that you are strong. It is at your weakest point that you are strong. And the Lord was telling me, tell this young lady whom I was with in counseling, the Lord was telling me, tell her that her testimony would be greater than all the setbacks she has gone through. She has gone through so many setbacks, but the Lord was telling me, her testimony will be greater than all the setbacks she has gone through. My dear brother, my dear sisters, you are here connected to Paul, who tells us that when I'm weak, amen, he says, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, St. Paul says, now that I know this, I now boast. I am now happy. He says, I'm now happy and glad about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power can rest upon me. This, and then he says in verse 10, this is why, for Christ's sake, I am glad in my weakness. When people insult me, I'm happy. When I'm in hardships, I'm happy. When I'm in persecutions, verse 10, please, let's read together. He says, that is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses. So he was a weak man, like all of us. And he says, even when people insult me, I'm okay. I'm glad. In hardships, I'm happy. In persecutions, I'm happy. In difficulties, I am a happy man. My dear brother, my dear sister, as you are there, are you a happy man? Are you a happy woman in your persecutions? When they persecute you at your workplace, when they persecute you in your marriage, when your in-laws persecute you, when your friends persecute you, when your fellow ministers persecute you, when your prayer group members persecute you, when you are in hardships, when you are in difficult moments, when you are insulted, when you are in weakness, are you a happy man? Are you a happy woman? St. Paul was always happy, because he knew the weaker he would be, the stronger he would be, because the power of God, take this serious from today, the power of God is perfected in our weakness. And that is why he says in St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8 and verse 18. And what does Paul say? Please share the link, invite many people. The Lord is giving you the grace to fall in love with Paul. And when you fall in love with Paul, I tell you, things will be better for you. Wow, thank you, Lord. Romans 8 and verse 18. What does Paul say? He says, and this is one of the verses I love. And maybe later on, before you finish the session, I'm going to ask you, what verse do you love most in the Pauline literature? In the Pauline letters, what verse do you love most? What verse works for you? This is one of the verses that is connected to what I'm talking about. And he says, I consider, Paul says, I, Paul, I, Morris, you can put your name. You can put your name, amen? Let me try to get your names here on the side. So you can put your name. Okay, hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. So Paul says, I consider that our present sufferings, our present, this guy gives motivation, I tell you. When you fall in love with his letters, your life will never be the same again. Amen. That is why he tells us in Romans 15 and verse 4. Let's go there, then you come here. Romans 15 and verse 4. Romans 15 and verse 4. What does he talk about when he talks about the word of God? What perspective does Paul have about the word of God? What perspective does Paul have about the word of God? What picture does St. Paul have about the word of God? Look at the perspective he has for the word of God. Look at how he looks at the word of God. I don't know how you look at the word of God. When the word of God is read at mass, how are you receiving it? Amen. Sometimes when I'm doing counseling, you know, I give only the word of God, word of God, word of God. And when I give the word of God and people are reading it, I feel as if I'm the one receiving it and jumping. I don't know how you feel as you receive the word of God. But St. Paul says, this is also another one of his letters, and he says, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us. And then he says, so that through the endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Can everybody write in the message and say, through the endurance and encouragement of scriptures, I will receive hope. Everybody write in the message. I'm going to give you some time to do that. Say it. Through endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, I will always receive hope. Through endurance and the encouragement of scriptures, I will always receive hope. And Lord, I want to pray for your children, especially those who have been hopeless, those who are in difficult situations, those who are in hopeless situations, those who are always regretting, those who are always troubled about their faith. They are always questioning about your presence. They're always asking, Lord, I pray and pray, but nothing I receive. Some of them have lost hope. Some of them can be here when their hearts are not here because they feel they are not yet there. Lord, I pray that tonight they may receive the grace to fall in love with your word. And as they meditate on your word, oh dear Lord, I pray they will receive hope. They will receive hope. They will be encouraged. They will find solace. They will find consolation. I pray for you, my dear brother, my dear sister, through the intercession of St. Paul, whom we celebrate today, that as you read the word of God, as you bury your head in the word of God, I repeat, as you read the word of God, I pray for you. As you bury your head in the word of the Lord, may your ears receive solace. May your ears receive encouragement. May your ears receive consolation. May your ears receive healing. Paul tells us, through the word of God, we shall receive hope. Are you somebody who has lost hope? My dear brother, my dear sister, here is where you should be. Romans 8 and verse 18, we read that and continue. Romans 8 and verse 18. Romans 8 and verse 18. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you. And you know, Romans 8 is a chapter about what? Let me see. You know, I want to make this interactive so that I can see how you guys are doing. What does Romans 8 talk about? Romans 8 is a chapter about something. What is that? Raise your hand and tell us. Let me unmute you so that you can speak. Please don't write in the message. If you know the answer, don't write in the message. If you know the answer, don't write in the message. I want to hear you speak so it's like a class. What does Romans 8 talk about? You know, Paul, St. Paul talks virtually about everything. I mean, St. Paul, in his letters, he summarizes every teaching of Jesus. He summarizes every teaching of Jesus and he even builds it. He puts more muscle. That is Paul for you. So in everything, talk about the giving to charity. Amen? Giving to charity. Maybe I should ask that question after this. Tell me, somebody, Romans 8. Romans 8 talks about what? Raise your hand, please. I said don't write in the message. Nobody knows in the meeting. Oh my God. Paul Banangapati Ambe, St. Paul, help us. Let your children fall in love with scripture today. Okay, Irene, tell us. What are you talking about, Irene? Please mute immediately because of time. I'm left with only 23 minutes now. Yes. Yes?
Life in the spirit.
Life in the spirit.
Thank you so very much.
That is it. Life in the spirit. The Holy Spirit. Thank you. And I was saying, St. Paul virtually talks about everything in the Bible. And he even gives muscle to what Jesus has talked about. He gives a deeper interpretation. Almost all the letters of Paul, you can listen to this. All the Pauline letters, 14 of them, 14 out of 27 books in the New Testament, 14 letters attributed St. Paul. Almost all in all his letters, he interprets the teachings of Jesus. You can write it in the message or in your chat room, in your notebook, so you can remember this. Pauline letters are about interpretation of the teachings of Jesus. So there's nobody who has interpreted the teachings of Jesus more than Paul. He has made the teachings to come alive to us. And he builds on these teachings. He even talks about many other things that Jesus himself did not talk about. Amen? And that is why he boasts. St. Paul boasts. He boasts and he says, not the negative boasting, but he wants to tell us, how did he receive all this knowledge? Galatians chapter 2. Give us Galatians. Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. How did Paul receive all this information that even the rest did not receive? Galatians chapter 2, and we read, hallelujah, Lord. Galatians chapter 2, and then we read, let me see. We read verse 11 and the following. Verse 11 to verse 12. Galatians chapter 2, 11 and 12 only. So what does he say? But Peter came to Antioch. Is that Galatians chapter 2? Sorry, Galatians chapter 1. You are giving us another one, something else. Galatians chapter 1, 11 and 12. Galatians 1, 11 and 12. What does he say? He says, Galatians 1, 11 and 12. He says, let me tell you, Paul is saying, let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, they were doubting his ministry. They were telling Paul, the Galatians were stubborn people. They were very stubborn people. Galatia was a city, was one of the cities in Greece. Galatia was one of the cities in what? In Greece, like you have Corinth, you have Athens, and many of them. And Thessalonica, you know, he has written a letter to the Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians. Both of them were Greek cities. The same as Corinth. Corinth was also a Greek city in Greece. And also, Galatia was one of them. So these were very stubborn people. And he really struggled to convert Galatians. Paul struggled to convert Galatians. Oh my God. And during his ministry in Galatia, he got a physical pain. He got sick in Galatia. And when he got sick, he wanted to give up. But the Lord told him, don't give up, my son. You are doing the right thing. And he started offering his pains for conversion of these people. And that is why the Galatians were so dear to St. Paul. And when they were so dear to St. Paul that he tells us in Galatians 4:19. What does St. Paul say in Galatians 4:19? He says, listen and see. He says, he calls the Galatians, my dear little children, the Galatians. He says, once again, just like a mother at childbirth. We are going to get another version, but let's first read this. He says, my dear children, once again, just like a mother in childbirth, I feel the same kind of pain for you until Christ's nature is formed in you. I feel the same pain. So he's virtually saying, give us another version. He's virtually saying, my children in whom I'm in labor. I love that version. My children in whom I am in labor until Christ is formed in you. Galatians 4:19, another version. Yes, it's here. My children, for whom I am again in the pains of childbirth. My version, the Catholic Answer Bible, what we call the Revised Standard Edition, says, my children in whom I'm in labor. But this one says, my dear children, for whom I am again in the pains of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. My dear brothers and sisters, we are all Galatians because we have been converted through, as you get us another version, we are all Galatians. Why am I saying that? We have all been converted through the ministry of Paul. Amen. We have all been converted through the ministry of what? Paul. Why am I saying that? Paul was an apostle to the Gentiles. St. Paul tells us in one of his letters, he says, the Lord who worked let me try to get this version so that I can touch many things that they go. Let me get this verse. He says, the Lord who worked, maybe somebody can Google for us, the Lord who worked in the ministry to the Jews in Peter is the same who worked in me, a ministry to the Gentiles, The Lord, let me see if I can Google it. The Lord who worked a ministry in Peter. So I was telling you that we are all children of Paul. Eh? We are, yes, you are all children of Paul, even if you are not, devoted to him. That is Galatians 2:8. Thank you. Galatians 2:8. So he says, For God, who was at work in the ministry of Peter as an apostle to the Jews, was also at work in my ministry as an apostle to the Gentiles. Amen. Meaning Peter was an apostle to the Jews, the chosen race, the people of God from the beginning of time. You know, the Jews were the chosen race. They were the holy nation. That is 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 and 8. 1 Peter chapter 2. Let's go there. 1 Peter chapter 2, 8 and 9. 1 Peter chapter 2. Kindly, those whose microphones are on, mute them. 1 Peter chapter 2. Please, those who are microphones are on, those. The rest of our hosts, help me on that, please. I'm running behind time already. Okay, so in this scripture we read, another scripture says, Peter says, this is the stone that will make people stumble, the rock that will make them fall. They stumbled because they did not believe in the word of God. Such was God's will for them. But the verse I wanted was verse 9. Let's give it another color, please. Verse 9. So verse 9 says, but you are a chosen race. Paul, you know, Peter wrote a church. Aha, this is another question for you. So Peter writes how many letters, by the way? By raising of your hand, please tell us, raise your hand. How many letters does Peter write? The Prince of the Apostles, the first Pope. How many letters does he write in the Bible? Yes, Vivian, stay and your family. Yes, Vivian? Vivian, please, you have talked to us, you have unmuted. How many letters does Peter write in the Bible? The Petrine. How many?
14.
Peter writes 14 letters? Vivian, talk to me, please. Vivian, where have you gone? Vivian, come back, please. Yeah. How many letters does Peter write in the Bible? How many? Okay, pray St. Paul today to give you the grace to fall in love with the Bible. Amina, can I hear your response?
Amina.
You pray after me. Say St. Paul.
St. Paul.
I do believe in you.
I do.
I do believe in you.
I do believe in you.
You have been given to us as a gift of grace.
You've been given to us as a gift of grace.
I pray to you today.
I pray to you today.
That on this special fifth day of your conversion.
That on this special fifth day of your conversion.
Give me the grace.
Give me the grace.
To fall in love.
To fall in love.
With scripture.
With the scripture. Amen.
With the scripture. Amen. Chiwede. God bless you and confirm that through St. Paul's intercession.
Amen and
in the name
amen.
Of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So some people are raising hands. Alan Aziza, how many letters does Peter write? Alan Aziza? Okay. Alan Aziza, can you? Okay.
There are 13 letters.
What? 13 letters written by Peter, right?
Yeah.
You tell us some of them. One, at least tell us like five. One.
There is a First Corinthians.
Oh my God, no. So you see, pray to Paul today. You make a prayer, say, oh, Saint Paul.
Saint make Paul. A prayer.
Help me.
Help me.
To fall in love.
To fall in love.
With the word of God.
With the word of God.
Amen. 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 Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let me get somebody else here. Oh my gosh. Definitely. How many letters does Peter write?
Two.
You are speaking emphatically with power, with grace.
Yes. With two.
Peter wrote two.
Yes.
Wow. You support? Let us first sample many of you. Let us sample many of you and see who supports and says Peter wrote two. Okay, let me
listen.
Susan Viarero. No, please, when I have not asked you to speak. You are on fire now. Okay. Susan Viarero, how many letters does Peter write?
Two.
Yes? Speak up, we're not hearing you.
He wrote two.
Okay. And lastly, from Mute Susani. Mute Susan, how many letters does Peter write?
He wrote two.
Thank you so very much. Let's get our scripture once again. 1 Peter, the one we had been sharing, 1 Peter 2 verse 9. 1 Peter 2 verse 9. Give us in yellow, please. Okay. Now, my dear sisters and brothers, Daphne was right. Peter wrote two letters. Now, the second question, please don't Google. The second question has a gift of a Bible. Peter is writing and he wrote two letters. To whom were his letters addressed? Because to which church was Peter writing to? Why am I asking this? Verse 9, but you are a chosen race. He tells these people, you are a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood. I wish we can get another version. This one waters it down. Give us another version, please. A royal priesthood and a holy nation. So I'm going to go into the last minutes of my program so that I can ask you questions and I see how you guys are doing. We have so much to talk about Paul, but the time is not there. We have to come for the Seven Sorrows Rosary. Verse 9. Yes, but you are a chosen people. You are a chosen people. Peter tells these people, and he calls them a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Amen. So this was the ministry. Peter's ministry was directed to people who are chosen, who are a royal priesthood, who are a holy nation. And I want to tell you, we are not part of that. Amen. I and you. We are children of the Gentiles. Just know it from today. If you didn't know it, we are descendants of the Gentiles. We are the children of the Gentiles from the beginning of time. Maybe if there is somebody there who is a Jew, who was born a Jew or has Jewish lines. But if you don't have any Jewish lines, you were never a chosen race. You were never a royal priesthood. You were never a holy nation. That is why Peter says, a people belonging to God. Amen. You were never that. But that was the ministry that God gave Peter. But then Paul was given a different ministry to the Gentiles. Now I'm asking a question. Which church was Peter addressing his letter? You can raise your hand. Which church was that? That one, I know. Which church was that? Yes, Faith Consulate Musime. Please don't Google. Don't Google. I want to test your Bible knowledge. Yes, Consulate, you are raising your hand.
Yes, Consulate. Brother. Yes, Brother Morris.
Which church was that?
I'm just thinking back of what I used to know of what where Peter wrote. As far as I can remember from my own divinity class, and you know, something to related to Christians in Asia Minor. That's what I can comprehend.
Peter, thank you. Peter even never stepped in Asia Minor. Peter never stepped in Asia Minor.
Asia Minor was the was pouring what? It was St. Paul's territory. St. Paul's territory. Okay. Arganila Raymond. Raymond, you speak. Why are you writing in the message to me? You speak, Raymond. Raymond, talk to us, please. Which church did Peter write this letter? One Peter, second Peter. And Brother Raymond. Brother Raymond, are you there? Yes.
Yes, brother.
So these the first Peter and second Peter are addressed to which church? The church in Rome, as you are saying?
I'm not sure, but I think it is Rome.
Now, Brother Raymond, was the church in Rome before the conversion, was it pagan or Jewish?
Pardon? It was pagan.
Pagan, and meaning they were Gentiles. So yes. They were never a chosen race. They were never a holy nation. They were never a royal priesthood. Thank you for trying, Brother Raymond. We shall be with you on Saturday. Many of you are going to see him, and he's going to give us a very powerful talk. Thank you, Raymond. Last, somebody, I give you another chance to somebody. Irina Sasra. Please don't write in the message. Please don't write in the message. If you are trying, just open the microphone and try. If you are trying, don't be shy. Be bold like Peter. Be bold like Peter. Peter never cared if he was making a mistake or not, if he was giving a wrong answer. And because of that, he became the prince of the apostles. Others were trying, were keeping quiet, saying, if I give a wrong answer, some of them were saying, they are going to laugh at me. Actually, that one is called pride. It is one of the manifestations of the vice of pride. One of the manifestations of pride is that you are always fearing to give a wrong answer. You're always fearing, how will they receive me? How will they? Maybe they're going to know that I'm very poor. So don't worry. Just say the way it is. The Lord will bless you for that. Yes, Irene.
Okay, too. I'm also guessing, but maybe the church was in Babylon. Maybe I'm just thinking.
Oh my God.
Since the Jews were there, or maybe they went to the Hebrews because the Hebrews are also called as Jews. I'm not sure.
Okay. No. Okay, somebody else, the last one, because now it's nine, it's almost nine. I have to give the microphone to Evelyn. Somebody wants to, yes, Rogers Atura. Atura Rogers, which church? Please don't Google. Which church? Yes.
Brother Morris, according to me, Peter is the founder of the Catholic Church, so he was in Rome.
Okay, so where was his letter being addressed to?
It was addressed in Rome, but I forgot the church.
How can he be in Rome and as well write a letter when he's in Rome? He just speaks them directly. All the letters Paul writes, he never writes a letter to the Galatians when he's in Galatia. Paul never writes a letter to the Corinthians when he's in Corinth. He never writes a letter to Timothy when he's with Timothy. He writes the letters and sends them. Amen? So he can never write to the Romans when he's in Rome. Like Paul writes a letter to the Romans. But he wrote that letter not in Rome. He wrote it when he was in Caesarea. So that one is totally wrong. Totally wrong. Let me give a last chance, maybe. Who has not spoken? Andrew Wasso. Andrew Wasso.
I think he was addressing it to the Gentiles.
Andrew Wasso, we have already heard Paul telling us that his ministry was to the Gentiles and Peter's ministry was to the Jews. So there is no way Peter would write to the Gentiles. No. Okay, let me leave that one, surely. You are going to research. I'm not going to give you the answer. You are going to research. So Peter is telling us that, Maria Nava, you are saying it's Asia. It's very wrong. Thank you for trying. So Peter says, we were not in any way a chosen people. Amen? We were never a royal priesthood. We were never a holy nation. That is why Paul tells us in Ephesians. Ephesians, please. Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 19. Let's start from verse 17, maybe. 17, 18, and 19. 17, 18, and 19. So Peter, Paul tells the Ephesians. And remember the church in Ephesus. The Ephesians were originally pagans. Amen? He converted them through a very tough time, I tell you. Paul spent time in Ephesus. It was one of the worst one of the places where he really received opposition. Where he converted the people through blood, through sweat. In the church in Ephesus. And Ephesus was a city which was like, you see, Kansanga. If the Kansanga of Kampala, one day Gaya, or which other place where people are very crazy, very crazy. So he wrote to them after, and he says, he came and preached peace to you who are far away. So my dear brother, my dear sister, even me and you, we are far away. If it was not Paul's ministry, if it wasn't Paul's ministry, that is why we need to talk about him. That's why we need to know him. That's why we need to esteem him. That is why we need to tell people about him. That is why we need to know what was his call, so that you can know who, what a special gift he is to us who are descendants of the Gentiles. We were very far away. That's why he tells Ephesians, you were very far away, and peace to those who are near. Then he says in verse 18, for through him, through Christ, we have, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Through him, through Jesus, because he had brought Jesus to these people, he says, through him, through Jesus, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. What does he mean by we both? Somebody can tell me very fast. What does he mean, we both? Somebody? There are some hands which were up already. Maybe I just throw at them. Okay. We both, he means that Gentiles and the Jews, I mean the chosen race, the holy nation, and those who are looked at as outsiders. And then he says in verse 19, which I wanted, verse 19, he says, consequently, you are no longer foreigners. You are no longer foreigners or aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household. Amen. So through the ministry of Paul, we are no longer foreigners anymore. We are no longer aliens. We are no longer sojourners, but we are fellow citizens. Through our baptism in the name of Jesus, we have been baptized in the name of Jesus. Amen. And because of that, we are now fellow citizens. We were very far away. Amen. And we are God's people and members of the household. So that is why he's crying when he was converting the Galatians. Galatians 4:19, as I end. Galatians 4:19. That's why he was crying, saying, you people, I have done so much to bring it to Christ. You were very far away. You didn't know about the Lord. I have done so much to bring you to Christ. And then he says, even now, my work in you is not yet accomplished. My work in you is not yet what? Accomplished. So even as I'm here and as you are there, is St. Paul's work in you accomplished yet? Or is still, or you are still in his what? In his womb. Because he says, my dear children, for whom I am in labor. I love that version. For whom I am in labor. Until Christ is formed in you. I love that version. I don't know why you are not getting it. My dear children, for whom I am again in the pains of childbirth. So if somebody is in pains of childbirth, it means he has you in his womb. He's the one who has conceived you. He's the one to bring you out and have life. Amen? He's the one to bring you out into this world and have life. That's why he says, my children, in whom I'm in labor until Christ is formed in you. And that is why when the Galatians later on, some people came and preached another message. You know, after he had left Galatia, other people came. There were Jews. Some of them were Gnostics, and many others. They came and preached another message in Galatia, and they confused the Galatians. Amen. These guys, that one is done. We can leave it. So they brought another message, another gospel, and confused the Galatians. And when they confused the Galatians, he was not a happy man. Galatians chapter 3. Give us Galatians chapter 3. St. Paul was not a happy man after they had been confused and they started even doubting his ministry. They started doubting the ministry of Paul. That's why he was defending himself, saying, I received everything through direct revelations from God. Let's Galatians 3. Galatians 3 as I end. Galatians 3 from verse 1. So, Galatians 3 from verse 1. You can go back to, okay. So he was not a happy man. That's what he called. He said, you foolish Galatians. I know many of you have read this. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Maybe as I'm here, he's also asking me the same question. He's also rebuking me. Yes, you cannot pretend to be holy, my dear. Maybe, yes, maybe even you. He's saying, you foolish Raymond, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus was clearly portrayed as crucified. And then he says, I would like to learn just one thing from you. St. Paul's, his letters would even make people cry. Do you know that? Paul would write a letter and he has not even gone himself. You know, sometimes he would go back and take charge of the church that has messed up. Amen. Sometimes he would go back and take charge of the church himself that has messed up and puts them back in the right path. But whenever he was not able to go, he would send Timothy. Whenever he was not able to go, he would send Timothy or Titus or many of his traveling companions. But especially the closest sons of Paul were Timothy and Titus. Like when the church in Corinth messed up, he sent a letter. He first sent Timothy, actually. He first sent Timothy, and when they did not listen to Timothy, he wrote a letter and gave it to Titus. So whenever they would mess up, he would send a letter. So sometimes even the letter of Paul would make people cry. Paul would write a letter to a church. People would cry, even old men, and say, who are we? How could we stoop down low to this extent? How do we not really stay with the message that this guy gave us through sweat, through blood? And they would cry, like it happened in Corinth, in the church in Corinth. Actually, he tells us somewhere where they cried in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, chapter 7, I think, from verse 7 to 10. He talks about it, but you can get time and go there. Maybe I just read it and finish this. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, chapter 7 from verse 8. You can start from verse 5. Even I'm eating into your time, I'm sorry. Start from verse 5. This letter he wrote to the Corinthians because his words were carrying grace. His words were letter and spirit. Amen. Brother Raymond knows the book written by Scott Hahn. Letter and spirit. His words were not only letter, they were full of the Holy Spirit. What about me and you as you are there? How are your words? Do your words have the Holy Spirit? Because when the words are spoken and spoken in such a way that they carry the Holy Spirit, they will impact on the people. It is called penetrative preaching of the word of God. It is called convincing preaching of the word of God. The word of God comes not as a letter only, but also as a spirit. So his words were not ordinary words. So one of the words he sent through a letter was to the church in Corinth. And he says, for when we came into Macedonia, Macedonia was one of the leading, was a very big province, and the capital of Macedonia was Philippi, whereby he writes the letter to the Philippians, Philippi. And he says, for when we came into Macedonia, this body of ours had no rest. You people, when you read the letters of Paul, you can even cry throughout the letters. You can cry throughout the letters, I tell you. They were so passionate, written with full of love for the people. Paul, even he says, I am willing to be spent and utterly spent. Let us get that verse. I am willing to be spent and utterly spent. I think it's in Romans chapter 9. I'm willing. Somebody can Google it. Can Google it if you are able to Google very fast. It should be Romans chapter 9. I'm willing to be spent. Somebody has got it. It is 2 Corinthians, sorry. 2 Corinthians chapter 15, verse chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 15. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 15. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 15. So he says, So I will very gladly spend. He says, I will very gladly spend for you everything. I wish I can get my version as well. But stay there. Let me see 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 15. 2 Corinthians. Chapter 12 and verse 15. Let me check my version. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 15. My version says, now, he says, I will gladly spend. I will most gladly spend and be utterly spent for your sakes. Listen to this. So let me read this. So I will very gladly spend for you everything I have. I will spend everything. Make sure you are converted. I will spend even every last coin, every last ounce of my life so that I can see you converted. So he says, so I will very gladly spend for you everything I have and expend myself as well. If I love you more, will you love me less? So Paul is asking you and me, if I love you more, will you love me less? So let me read my version, which is somewhat better. It says, verse 15, it says, I will most gladly spend and be utterly spent for your sakes. I will most gladly spend. Some of you, when we invite you to go to Munyonyo, we have a program in Munyonyo on Saturday, Our Lady of Chibeho. Some of you have money, you can really contribute the ministry, because we are going to spend so much money on the day, like almost like 1.5 million. Amen. And when we ask you, at least share something that can help us do this, go through this day. Even if you have money, you will not give it. Why? Because you are not having a Pauline mentality. You don't have the Pauline spirit. I pray for you today that you may receive a Pauline spirit. St. Paul says, I will spend everything I have, and even I myself will be spent because of you. And he says, because of this, I'm expressing my love for you. Let me see how you will not love me. Let me see how you will love me less when I have spent everything I have and have even spent myself. Make a prayer and say, Lord, give me a Pauline spirit. Make a prayer, write in the message, Lord, give me a Pauline spirit. Lord, give me a Pauline spirit. Have you arrived at that level whereby you even have no time to eat your food? You have no time to eat your food because you are saving souls. You have no time even for yourself. Sometimes, I don't want to speak this, but sometimes I have no time for myself. I have no time for my family. Even now as I'm here, there are many needs. My wife called me when I was doing counseling, and she said, there are many things I want you to come back with home. I told her, okay, write them on WhatsApp. I will try to look for them and buy them and bring them home. And now it is 9 p.m. It is 9 p.m. I'm still at Christ the King. My driver is parked somewhere there. He's also waiting for me. Amen. That is it. We should spend and be ready and willing to be spent ourselves. Utterly spent. I love that version, but I've not got it. I am willing to spend and be utterly spent for your sake. Amen. Make a prayer. Lord, give me a pouring spirit. Lord, give me a pouring spirit. Some of you here are what? You know, we have a group called the service team. Because I'm not doing this work alone. I'm not doing it with Evelyn alone. We have a service team. Many people who are doing this work. But sometimes I can see many weaknesses in the service team. People are not willing to give their lives to the service of God. Amen. You want to leave something for yourself. Now, Paul, I will gladly spend and utterly be spent. Have you reached at that level? Pray for it. When you pray, when you reach at that level, your life will be a miracle. Your life will be what? A miracle. Your life will begin, even your body will begin to exude the presence of God, as I finish giving. Even you, when you speak, when you reach at that level, your life, can those who are really microphone on, can they take them off? Maybe I mute you. Amen. When you reach at that level, your life will become a miracle. I tell you, even your body will exude the presence of God. Your words will touch people and heal them. One time, Paul was in a place called Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles. Let me show you what happened to Paul because of his life, because of his love for the Lord. Because of his love for the what? For the Lord. The Lord began to use Paul, I tell you. Acts of the Apostles, chapter. Let's read this. Acts of the Apostles. Let's read chapter. Just a few of them, Evelyn, and I allow you to come. Acts of the Apostles. He was in a city called what? Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. In Lystra. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 14. Look at what the Lord worked in the life of Paul. Because Paul had a special spirit. He was willing and ready to do what we call kenosis. Kenosis. It's called kenosis. Emptying yourself.
I think it's Brother Raymond with the network problem. Sorry, okay. Brother Moritz.
Okay, I'm back. Sorry, just let me finish up this. Let me show you how the Lord used Paul. Hope now I'm okay. It was my Wi-Fi. It got a problem. Now I'm using the internet for the phone. So let's read from verse 8. Acts of the Apostles, 14 from verse 8. I'm going to give you three places where the Lord really demonstrated his power through Paul because of his what? Because of his love for the Lord. Can we share, please, Evelyn? You are now a host, a co-host. Evelyn, share for us. Acts of the Apostles. Evelyn, share for us. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 14, from verse 8. I'm trying to show you how the Lord used Paul because he was willing to live for the Lord. He was willing to live for the Lord. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 14, from verse 8, as we end our discussion on Paul. From verse 8, and we read up to verse 16. After verse 16. So Paul was in Lystra. I think this was the second missionary journey. It was his second missionary journey. Most likely it was his second missionary journey. Second or first one of them. So in Lystra, look at what the Lord accomplished in the hands of Paul. In Lystra, there was a man who had been lame from birth and had never been able to walk. So he sat there and listened to Paul's words. He listened to Paul's what? Words. Remember, I told you, Paul's words, it was word and letter and spirit. I told you that, I hope you remember. Paul's words were so anointed. It was letter and spirit. And we pray that the Lord may anoint our words as well. So he listened to Paul's words. So Paul saw that he believed and could be healed. Paul saw the man who was born lame. He said, the way the guy is looking at me as I preach the word of God, the way this lame man is attentive, the way this lame man is gesturing. I think when Paul was preaching, the lame man was doing like this. Oh my God, he was clapping. And as he was doing that, it touched Paul. And Paul said, see what this man is facing. Jesus is building. He's building and building. And Paul looked at him straight. And what did he say? In a loud voice, verse 10, he said, stand up straight on your feet. When he made these words, did the man stand? Stand up straight on your feet. What happened? The man jumped up and started walking around. That is Paul for you. And when the crowd saw Paul, saw what Paul had done, they started shouting in their own Lyconian language, the gods have become like men and have come down to us. My dear brother, my dear sister, the moment you fall in love with Jesus, the moment you want to imitate Jesus, Paul tells us in Galatians 2:20. Give it to us very fast. Galatians 2:20, verse 20. What does Paul say? He says, so that it is no longer I that live, but it is Christ who lives in me. Look at this. Paul says, now that I have come to know Jesus, now that I have encountered Jesus, I don't care who I was in the past life. And because of that, I have died to myself. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Philippians 1:21. What does he say? Philippians 1:21. What does Paul say? So he says, for what is life? Amen. Paul is saying, for what is life? You people, let's pray to St. Paul. Let's pray to him. We can also be like him if we really work hard. We can be like him. So he says, for what is Christ? For what is Christ? I mean, he says, for what is life? Sorry. For what is life to me? It is Christ. What about you? What about me? What is life to you? Is life to you money? Some of us, life is money. Some of us, life is having a good job. Some of us, life is being married. You have children. If you arrive at that, you say, now I get married. I have good children. I have a wife. That is life to me. Wapi? St. Paul says to me, life is Christ. When they promote you at work, you feel you have exhausted everything. You feel you have arrived at the pinnacle of joy and happiness.
When you are driving a good car, you feel you have arrived at the pinnacle of joy and happiness. When you feel your bank account is fat, Paul says, that is useless to me. Life is Christ. Amen. Let's get another place about Paul. And I think that is 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, he says, while I was with you, I did not care about anything. Which one was that? He says, where is that? I wanted to read this as well, but I don't remember where it is. He says, while I was with you, I did not give time to anything, but only Christ and Christ crucified. Where is that? Somebody can help us. While I was with you, I did not care about anything else, but about Christ and Christ crucified. It is in Corinthians, but I don't remember where. Oh God, give us this scripture. It is so special. It's so, so special. Evelyn, I have said it many times, but I don't remember what it is. Okay. Let's leave that one. Let's go to you have got it? It's not that. Let's see another area where God works through Paul. Acts of the Apostles, let's go back. Another area where God works through Paul. Raymond was sharing about it recently in Cyprus. In Cyprus, Acts of the Apostles 13. Acts of the Apostles 13. From verse 4 until verse 12, another area where God works through Paul in a very extraordinary way. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 13, from verse 4 to 12. Evelyn, from verse 4 to 12. Acts of the Apostles, 13, 4 to 12. Oh, dear Lord, we want to thank you so very much. Yeah, the other one was 1 Corinthians 2, 2. We shall go to it. Thank you, Zarango. 1 Corinthians 2, 2. Thank you. So let's see another area where the Lord works through Paul because of how Paul was to the Lord. So he says, having been sent by the Holy Spirit, Barnabas and Saul went to Seleucia and sailed from there to an island called Cyprus. So that was the first missionary journey of Paul, and he went with Barnabas. That one, I hope you know it very well. Then verse 2, when they arrived at Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogues. They had with them John Mark to help them in their work. So John Mark was a traveling companion, but just to help them in their work, carry their luggages. That was John Mark, just carrying their luggages. And why did John Mark come with them? Because Barnabas, one of the main people on that journey, had a soft spot for John Mark. I'm going to ask a question about this, maybe to see how you guys are doing in Bible study. So Paul travels with Barnabas on his first missionary journey, but then they don't leave somebody called John Mark. Why? Because Barnabas had a soft spot for John Mark. That is why later on, when there was a disagreement between Paul and Barnabas, who was the cause? John Mark. And Bible tells us after that heated disagreement, after that heated moment, Paul never moves with Barnabas. Barnabas takes his own way. Paul takes his own way. And from that moment, we never hear about Barnabas in the Bible. How did it come? Because somebody was willing to favor somebody called John Mark. And I'm asking you a question. Why was Barnabas favoring John Mark? Who can try? Why was Barnabas favoring John Mark? This guy even brought a disagreement between the two, and it became an irreconcilable disagreement. Why was Barnabas having a soft spot for John Mark? Somebody try, raise your hand. Why? All of us, nobody has the answer. Why? Raymond, are you there? Yeah, good. Evelyn, why was Barnabas having a soft spot for John Mark? Evelyn? Okay. The answer is John Mark was a cousin of Barnabas. Was a cousin. By the way, that John Mark is the writer of the Gospel according to St. Mark. But later on, they reconciled. But they never moved together anymore. So what happened? I was showing the power of Paul, that the Lord had worked in Paul. So they went all the way across the island of Paphos, where they met a certain magician called Bar-Jesus, a Jew who claimed to be a prophet. So what happened? He was a friend of the governor of the island, Sergius Paulus, who was an intelligent man. The governor called Barnabas and Saul before him because he wanted to hear the word of God. So the governor was the one who was in charge of that province. And when he heard about Paul and Barnabas and what they were doing, he called them so that he can listen to the word of God. And that touched Paul and Barnabas. And they said, oh God, we have got now chance to speak the word of God to the big people. Those who are influential. When they are converted, even their subjects will convert. So what happens? Verse 8. But they were opposed by a magician called Elymas. That is his name in Greek. Who tried to turn the governor away from the faith. So this magician had always been confusing the governor. This magician called Elymas had always been confusing the governor because he was winning favors from the governor, confusing him. So when Barnabas and Paul came, they came with a different power. And because of that, Elymas got jealousy. And he said, these people are going, bagenda kundiao. They are going to take my position. They are going to have more favor before the governor than me. So what did he do? Verse 9. Then Saul, also known as Paul, was filled with the Holy Spirit. Look at Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit. I pray through the intercession of Paul, we may all be filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul had a very special love for the Holy Spirit. And he talks about the Holy Spirit more than any evangelist in the Bible. Maybe that one will be a talk for another day, but he was such a man who had fallen in love with the Holy Spirit. So he was filled with the Holy Spirit and he looked straight at the magician. And what did he say? Verse 10 and 11. Verse 10 and 11. He looked straight at the magician. Verse 10 and 11, yes. So he looked straight at the magician and said, you son of devil, you son of the devil, you are an enemy of everything that is good. You are full of all kinds of evil tricks and you always keep trying to turn the Lord's truth into lies. That was not enough for Paul. He wanted to do something more spectacular. May the Lord give you the grace to always do spectacular things for the glory of God. So what did he do? Verse 11, the Lord's hand by his word, listen, through his word, he said, the Lord's hand will come down on you now. Please remove that. He says, the Lord's hand will come down on you now. You will be blind and will not see the light of the day for a time. Paul speaks and the Lord anoints his words. My dear brother, my dear sisters, let's pray for the Pauline spirit. That when we speak, the Lord may anoint our words. And our words will bring impact to community. Our words will be healing. Will bring grace. That is why Paul says in Colossians. That is another Pauline scripture. You can get it. Colossians chapter 4 verse 6. Colossians 4 verse 6. He says, let your speech be seasoned like salt. Let your words be seasoned like salt. So they can be efficacious and edifying to the people who listen to them. Ephesians 4 verse 6, your speech should always be present and interesting, and you should know how to give the right answer to everyone. This is a watered down version. Give me another version, please. Another version which is not watered down. Another version of Colossians 4 6. Colossians 4 6, another version. Maybe another version. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. St. Paul, pray for us. St. Paul, we dedicate this ministry to you. You are so good to us. You have been there for us. Give us more yearning for you. Give us more devotion for you. Let us know you more than we have ever done. And let us be able to imitate you, because you have told us in 1 Corinthians 11:1, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. We pray for a greater imitation of Christ through your intercession. So he says, let your conversation, let your words be always full of grace. Always full of grace. So as I am here, as you are here, listening to this memorial lecture on St. Paul, as you are listening, as I'm listening, in this memorial talk on St. Paul, are your words always full of grace? Are your words always full of grace? He says, let your conversation, even your conversation on WhatsApp, even when we end this program and you go to WhatsApp in the night, when we end our prayers and you go to WhatsApp, what are you going to send to people? What conversation will you have? What conversation is on your emails? What conversation are you always having in your office? St. Paul says, let your conversation always be full of grace, seasoned with salt. You know, salt makes everything sweet. If you take food without salt, it's as if the food is what? Tasteless. But when the salt is introduced, the food becomes tasty. Amen? Most more of you love to go to test and tasty, something like that. And then he says, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Other version says, so that your words may be edifying and efficacious. So the words of Paul never had vulgar. They never had anything bad. Everything that came out of the mouth of Paul was edifying. Everything that came out of the mouth of Paul was glorifying the Lord. That is why when he speaks to Elymas, let's go back. Acts of the Apostles, the one we have been having. Acts of the Apostles, when he rebukes Elymas, the magician. That was Acts of the Apostles. Are you there, Evelyn, or you have forgotten? It's Acts of the Apostles. Okay. Well, which, no, not that one. Okay, so verse 11. No, go back to 13, then verse 11. Mm-hmm. So he speaks his word and he says, the Lord's hand, you Elymas, the magician, who is trying to alter the word of God, who is trying to oppress the word of God. He says, you, the Lord's hand will come on you now. You will be blind and you will not see the light of the day anytime. And what happened? The Lord anointed the word of Paul. The Lord anointed the word of Paul. He made sure the ministry of Paul had wonders and signs. And that is a promise in Mark chapter 16, verse 20. We are going to go there very shortly. So God anointed his words. He accompanied the words of Paul with wonders and signs. That is what we are praying for today. Amen. So what happened? At once, Elymas felt a dark mist cover his eyes. He walked about trying to find someone to lead him by the hand. And verse 12, this one converted the governor. Verse 12, it converted the governor. Maybe you need to convert your boss at work who doubts about Mother Mary. Maybe you need to convert your supervisor who is always asking you, why do you pray all the time? Maybe you need to convert your dad who doesn't believe in what you are doing even now. So verse 12. So what happens? The miracle that the Lord did, the wonder that the Lord did, converted the governor immediately. Sometimes we don't need to preach for long. Sometimes we don't need to talk a lot. Sometimes we don't need to convince people with words. Yes, you need to arrive at this level of faith so that you don't need to always convince people with words. Amen? Sometimes the Lord can give you grace to work wonders, miracles, extraordinary things. And through them, people will be converted. And many people will be converted. So what happened? When the governor... he believed without any more preaching, for he was greatly amazed at the teaching by the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, as we finish this, this is my promise. This is your promise. Don't say, Bananga, you are Brother Morrissey. They are even in you, you are Paul. They are for everybody. That is a promise in Mark 16:20. We finish from there. Mark 16:20. That's a promise from Jesus for us. For all who are desiring to minister, to do ministry of the word of God, those who are desiring to be preachers, teachers, evangelists, this is your promise for every one of us. What does it say? Verse 20, the disciples went and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them. He worked with them. So in your life, is the Lord working with you? In your marriage, is the Lord working with you? In your ministry, is the Lord working with you? Like he worked with Paul? He worked with Paul everywhere. What about you? Is the Lord working with you? If he's not working with you, ask Paul. Please send Paul. The Lord worked with you. Even when you are on the sea, he worked with you. Remember what happened in the island in the sea near Malta. You have read the story in Acts of the Apostles 26 and 27. What happened at the sea? You should go there and read Acts of the Apostles 26 and 27 and 28. God was with Paul at the sea. Even at the island, a great miracle happened in the island of Malta. And all the Maltese were converted. Even there is a church in Malta where people go for pilgrimage, and the church is dedicated to St. Paul. So the Lord worked with Paul everywhere. Let us pray to St. Paul that the Lord may work with us everywhere. But first, we need to work on our lives. So Paul says, Jesus says, the disciples went about everywhere and preached the word of God. And the Lord worked with them and proved that their preaching was true by miracles that were performed, by wonders. I love another version. Give us another version, please. Another version of 20. Another version where it says, he accompanied them and confirmed their word. I love that. He accompanied them and confirmed their word. Okay. So the disciples went out and preached everywhere. And the Lord worked with them. And that's what I love. And confirmed his word. He confirmed their words. Like he confirmed the words of Paul by signs that accompanied them. And lastly, about the Pauline ministry, accompanied by the Lord, is Acts of the Apostles 18. Acts of the Apostles 19 from verse 11 and 12 that we have shared many times. Acts of the Apostles 19, verse 11 and 12. verse 11 and 12. God was performing unusual miracles through Paul. Other versions call them uncommon miracles, extraordinary miracles. Extraordinary, uncommon, unusual, the same word. Even handkerchiefs and aprons he had used were taken to those who were ill. You know, Paul would minister for long hours. Eh? Paul had that grace. He would minister for long hours. He would preach for almost day and night. One time in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20, I think, chapter 20, he preached and they were in a storied house. They were in a storied house. I think it's Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20. But because of time, yes, chapter 20 from verse 7. From verse 7, because of time, let's not go there. From verse 7, they were in a storied house and he preached. I think from around 7 in the afternoon, in the evening, he preached and preached, preached and preached until almost 5 in the morning. Even in together, Kusura Wano. Okay, you put and we see. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20 from verse 7. From verse 7. On Saturday evening, we gathered together. On Saturday evening, we gathered together because on Saturdays, they would preach the word of God in the synagogues or in their small places of worship. And then on Sunday, they would make the sacrifices. So on Saturday evening, we gathered together for the fellowship meal. Paul spoke to the people and kept on speaking. Some of you are always blaming me. Brother Morris, when you are speaking, you don't end. Your sessions do not end. I don't know if I got the point in the spirit. I'm just joking. Paul preached and spoke to the people and kept on speaking. Sometimes it is necessary. Yes. So some of you, when they speak for 1 hour, you say, oh my God, this sermon is very long. The father cannot finish. Father is preaching until tomorrow. When shall we leave? Some of you are saying these things of OLSG are always there. They don't end. Paul spoke to the people and kept on speaking until midnight, since he was going to leave the next day. So what happens? Many lamps were burning in the upstairs room. They were in the upper room, so they had put lamps where there was a meeting. Now what happened? The young man named Etius was sitting in the window. He was sitting on the window, on the window. And as Paul kept on talking, Etius got sleepier and sleepier. Even as I'm talking now, some of you are getting sleepier and sleepier. Even as the session is going in the night, anyway, you are attending Holy Mass, you are attending a retreat, you get sleepier and sleepier. Hey, something may come out, my dear, of your sleeping. So the young man got sleepier and sleepier until he finally went across my address on the window, and he got sleepier and sleepier in the air. He fell off the window. He kept on dozing. He fell until he finally went sound asleep and fell into the third story, from the third story to the ground, where they picked him up and he was dead. He was dead completely. Let me ask you a question. Why did this man sleep? There was a factor. Now, I'm so much into your time. There was a factor that made this man sleep. Not only the long preaching of Paul, there was something else that made him sleep. Who can tell us? I want to see people who are very sharp. If you are not sharp here, you can never get it. Please don't write in the message, I want to hear from you. You are going to copy for others. Here, if you are not sharp, you can never get it unless you are really, they are called gifted learners. Unless you are a gifted learner. And if you give me the answer, truly you are a gifted learner. If you give me the right answer, you are truly a gifted learner. Let me start with Odota Lydia. Odota Lydia, yes?
I'm just trying. Good evening, everyone.
Your network is poor. You are saying what?
Just trying. Let me try and see.
Uh-huh.
The guys slept and fell down. Reason Jesus wanted to perform his miracle through Paul by raising him from the dead.
That one was it, but not the... What I want to know, what made this man sleep to the extent that he fell down? Thank you for trying. There is something that made him sleep. There was a factor. There was a catalyst. What I may call a catalyst. The catalyst is Emmanuel Akejo.
Wandering spirit.
The what?
I said wandering spirit.
What is that?
Yeah, what I wanted to say earlier on what Lydia has shared already. I think God just wanted to reveal his glory by enabling Paul to perform a miracle through him to resurrect him.
Okay, so thank you for trying, but that was not the catalyst. That was something that came out later. That was something else. But there was a catalyst that made him doze. What was that? Munduru, Florence. Munduru. Munduru?
Yes. To my own understanding, like when Paul was preaching, at first the man had faith. That's why he kept listening. He kept participating in the whatever, in the preaching of St. Paul. But it reached time when he got like, maybe the faith was becoming shallow.
So the faith becoming shallow was the catalyst? Wait. The faith becoming shallow was the catalyst? No, thank you for trying though. At Kwase Claire. At Kwase Claire.
This is that.
Your microphone?
Okay, this is that. This is Daphne.
Daphne who?
Nachiwala.
So you are staying together now. Okay, tell us what was the catalyst? You are a scientist, you are a lab attendant, you are a lab technician, sorry. So tell us what could be the catalyst. You know what a catalyst is. What was that?
I think it was a spirit of drowsiness that attacked him.
Somebody had said it already. That was not. So thank you for trying. Orichiriza, Julian, Orichiriza.
I think what made Eustace sleep, because it was at night, and in the room where they was, I mean, where they were listening to Paul, there was not enough oxygen, because we read that there were many lamps which were lit, meaning there were many people, and due to lack of oxygen and that fatigueness.
Okay. Thank you for trying. Because of time, we are not going to go any further. Thank you for trying, but not the answer, Shuari. You are putting a lot of science. Yes, Doreen. Doreen? Yes, Doreen? Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, Doreen.
Unfortunately, I also had the answer, which is in verse 8.
So tell us the answer. Mm-hmm.
The many lamps were burning, so the heat could have contributed to the reason as to why he fell asleep.
Thank you so much. The wonderful atmosphere of the many lamps were burning, and the atmosphere changed. It was so warm. It became so warm for this guy that in the process, his body gave up. He failed. That was the answer. Thank you so very much. Very few people could pull it out. So what happened? But Paul went down and through, you know, when you have children, many of you have children, when you want children to sleep, when you want children to sleep in the night, what do? You cover them with more blankets. So the warmer it becomes, then they are able to sleep. Even you, the moment, remember when you are in school and you go to class to read, you wake up early to read, and then you are reading, you are putting on something on the head, you are putting on a jumper, you are putting on a sweater, you are putting on a scarf, you are putting something in the legs, immediately will doze. So the warmer it becomes, the easier for you to doze. So the guy dozed because of the many lamps. So what happened? He fell down and was dead. But Paul went down and threw himself on him and hugged him. Can you imagine? And he said, don't worry. People were crying. They knew Etchus was gone. But Paul had faith that Jesus, whom he was preaching, he would raise this man. So he fell down on him, and by his hug, he hugged him. After hugging him, he held him onto his heart, and then climbed again upstairs. And when they were upstairs, they laid the man flat down, and then Paul, all these are not here, but I have read them somewhere. So what did Paul do? Paul celebrated the Holy Mass. What is the morning? Paul celebrated the Holy Mass, the Holy Eucharist, and by the end of the Holy Mass, the man was already having life. So that's why they say they took the young man home alive and were greatly comforted. So through the sacrifice of Mass, the man was up. That was the faith of Paul. So my dear brothers and sisters, that was Paul for you. And how did Paul arrive at this he left everything. Paul left everything, as we read in 1 Corinthians. Let's get that. 1 Corinthians 2, 2, and then the last scripture will be Philippians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians, what is 1 Corinthians 2, 2? Yes. Why did the Lord fall in love with Paul? Why did the Lord anoint Paul in such a way? Why did he use Paul in such a way than even the people who were with Jesus for 3 years? Do you know the Lord used Paul than the apostles who are with Jesus for 3 years? I repeat, the Lord used Paul, not only in just the miracles, even on the miracles, but even in what has come as scripture that has been adopted in the doctrine of the church, 14 letters. Even the areas that Paul converted almost the whole world. More than the people who are with Jesus, who saw the miracles, whom Jesus prayed for in John 17, he prayed for them. Why did God use Paul to such an extent? By the way, the Lord used Paul to the extent that even what, this is another question, this one I will give 50,000. 50,000, and I will send it on your mobile money even now, if you answer it right. If you answer it right, I will send it on mobile money after this session. The Lord used Paul to the extent that even what the evangelists, the four gospel writers who witnessed the ministry of Jesus, and wrote about what Jesus spoke to them, Paul even wrote about things Jesus spoke that were not even written by the apostles. I repeat, Paul wrote about things that Jesus taught about that you can never find in the Gospels. And there is one place in the Pauline works whereby he talks about something that you can never find in the Gospels. And when he talks about it, he's quoting Jesus. He quotes Jesus on something that is not quoted by the evangelists, by the gospel writers. What did he quote? Which place is that? 50,000 direct to you. And please don't try to Google, because you are going to cheat yourself. And the Lord will not be pleased with you. Tell me about it. What was that? I'm trying to do this so that I can raise your love for Paul. Not that because I have enough money. No, I don't have enough money. But I want to raise your love for Paul so that you can go and bury yourselves in these letters in the Bible, and you're going to learn so much and your life will be transformed. So what was that? Paul writes about something, quotes Jesus on what even the evangelists, the gospel writers have never heard about and have never written. What was that? Somebody, raise your hand. So where have you gone? Where have you gone? Come back as we finish. Eh? Where? I have shared this in the Bible school. I can't imagine that even the people in the Bible school don't know this. I have shared it in the Bible school. Yes, Julian Richardson. Tell us, what did Paul quote about Jesus that even the gospel writers have not told us?
It is in Acts chapter 35, Acts chapter 20, verse 35.
Uh-huh. Can you even show it to us? Even go there, please. Go there. Acts 20, 35. You are in the answer. You are swimming in the answer, my sister. So the 50K is coming already. Okay, tell us originally.
Okay, Jesus Paul says that in every way I have shown you that by hard work of that sort we must help the weak and keep in mind the words of the Lord Jesus, who himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive.
Mm-hmm.
So Paul was telling the believers this statement, but this statement is not stated anywhere in the Gospels.
And what does that mean to you?
It means Paul was receiving like direct teaching from Jesus himself, not from anyone, but though he didn't attend the life ministry, the physical life ministry of Jesus with the apostles, but here he was receiving even more than those who had attended in truth and in spirit.
Thank you so very much. Your 50,000 is coming. Let's go to Galatians chapter 1, verse 11, and to give confirmation to this. Galatians chapter 1, verse 11 and 12. Maybe today we are not going to have a deeper meditation of the rosary. We shall have tonight with the Lady of Sorrows. We can do this as a gift to St. Paul, as an homage to St. Paul taking all this time. We are talking about him. So in the end, when clock's 10, we are not going to have the other longer rosary. We shall have the litany of the Holy Name of Jesus. And after the litany of the Holy Name of Jesus, we shall have a shorter version of the Rosary of Seven Sorrows tonight with the Lady of Sorrows. So we are doing this in homage to this great apostle for whom we are, our conversion is solely resting on his shoulders. So what did he say? Let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preach is not of human origin. That is Paul for you, not of human origin. He was not doing this because he wanted to boast. No, he was not doing this because he was proud, but they were opposing his apostleship. They were shedding many doubts about him. You are not even one of the original apostles. How dare you speak to us with authority? You don't have any authority. Speak to us. Where did you get your message? You were not there when Jesus was preaching. You were not commissioned. So Paul says, let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preach is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any human being. Hey, don't joke with Paul, my dear brother, my dear sister. Don't joke with Paul. That is what he says. I not received from any human being, nor did anyone teach it to me. It was Jesus Christ himself who revealed it to me. That is why when Paul was beheaded in Rome in a place called the Three Fountains, I was there in 2019. That was one of the gifts, that is one of the many gifts that Paul has given me. And I don't deserve them, but he has given them to me. It's a gift. It's a free gift from God. As he tells us in 1 Corinthians 4, I think verse 12, that everything we have has come as a gift from the Lord. So he gifted me to go and see where he gave up his life for Jesus. So I traveled to Rome in 2019, to a place called St. Paul's Basilica. And then there is St. Paul, there is a place called the Three Fountains. And on that place, when they were leading Paul out from the Mamertine prison in Rome for his martyrdom on the same day with Peter, because both of them were killed on the same day in Rome. But Peter was killed within the city walls. But Paul, being also a Roman, he was not killed inside. He was killed outside the walls. That is why his basilica is called St. Paul's Basilica Outside the Walls. I was also there in the basilica, and I saw his grave where he was buried. I went there myself. I saw myself. I knelt down and prayed. I saw his catacomb. I even saw the chains that were holding him. The chains he talks about in many of his letters, the glorious chains he talks about. So they were able to retrieve some of his chains that they were holding him as a prisoner, and you can see them. And his head, part of his head is in Basilica Santa Maria Maggiore. They got part of his remains, I think a head, a scar, something like that, and they took it away. How did they discover the tomb? Maybe you can remove the sharing. How did they discover the tomb of Paul? You know, after many centuries, when the Catholic Church had established itself in the imperial city of Rome, after some time, they started digging up many places in Rome, because there were places of serious importance to the church. Most of the first martyrs of Rome were buried deep under. So as they were digging up, they came to a place, a tomb that had an inscription. And the inscription was Paulo. I just put it in English. That one was Latin. It was Paul, Apostle and Martyr. Apostoli and Mater, something like that. Paul, Apostle and Martyr. That is when they came to know, oh my God, this is St. Paul's tomb. And they excavated it and carbon dated. Those of you who know science, carbon dating. Carbon dating, you get the remains and test them, and you can know when the remains existed, when the tomb was made. And it dated around 79 AD, the year when Paul was what? Was martyred in Rome. So it was St. Paul's tomb. That is why the Basilica, St. Paul Outside the Walls Basilica, St. Paul's Basilica, is built exactly on the burial ground of Paul the Apostle. Yes. So they were able to get many things. One of them was part of his remains, and they took the part of his remains to Basilica Santa Maria Maggiore, what we call Mary Major Basilica, the basilica, the oldest Marian Basilica in Rome, which I also visited. And when you go there, you can even see the head of Paul, even the head of Saint Jerome. Many of you know Saint Jerome. Saint Jerome, who translated the Bible from Greek and I think also Aramaic into Latin, and then from Latin to other languages. Saint Jerome, one of the best doctors of the church. Saint Jerome, even one of the remains of Saint Jerome are in Basilica Santa Maria Maggiore. So I pray for you, my dear brothers and sisters, and I pray that you may fall in love with Paul. When you fall in love with him, he will take you to all these places. He will do. Me, I didn't have any money to go, but he did that miracle for me. And when I was there, as I close, when I was there, I said, Paul, what can I do? What can I do for me? What can I do that when I go home, I will be good. I will feel good about it. And Paul inspired me to look into my wallet, to pick my wallet and look into it. And when I looked into my wallet, I found a picture of Paul, my son, Paul, my firstborn, and immediately removed it and dropped it in the catacomb, in the tomb where Paul was buried. And I said, Paul, you, my father, I give you this son of mine, take charge of him. And I was very happy about it. I don't know what Paul will do in my son, Paul, whom I mentioned, whom I named after him. I don't know what he'll do in his life. And my second son is Timothy, and Timothy's feast day is tomorrow, because today has been the feast day of conversion of Paul. Tomorrow is the feast day of Timothy and Titus, two of the greatest, of the favorite traveling companions of Paul. And Paul converted both of them, and he also anointed them and commissioned them as ministers. So when Paul left Asia Minor and he went on other journeys to Jerusalem, then to Rome, he left them, young as they were, as bishops of two major cities. Timothy, as young as he was made a bishop by Paul of Ephesus, the first or the maiden bishop of Ephesus at his young age. That is why Paul tells him in 1 Timothy, Evelyn, 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, a very special scripture for those who are still young. 1 Timothy 4, verse 12. And I used to claim this scripture many times when I was still a young man and trying to become an evangelist and trying to be a leader in God's things of God. I claimed it many times, and I also recommend it to you to claim it. 1 Timothy 4, verse 12. 1 Timothy 4, verse 12. There you go. So he said, do not let anyone look down on you because you are young. Timothy was so young, but made a bishop. Why? Because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. He was a lover of Jesus. He had imitated Jesus in the way of St. Paul. He was such a gifted man at his young age. He was flaming with the love of Jesus. During the first missionary journey, Paul met Timothy in Lystra. Paul met Timothy in Lystra, and Paul met Timothy with his mother, Eunice, and even his grandmother, Louis, was there. And when Timothy saw Paul and how Paul was inflamed with the love of Jesus, and Timothy said, I have to go with you. I have to go with you. I can even carry your bag. I can carry your migugu, but I have to go with you. I'm not staying here. But Paul said, no, I can't take you. You are still young. Then on the second journey, as they were passing through the same town, this time Timothy had grown somehow older, and his love for the Lord had gone to another level. And Paul said, come, I will take you on. And he started walking with Paul, carrying his luggages, being a messenger of Paul. And Paul would send him many times. He would send him to give him letters many times. But because of his association with Paul, he would never associate with Paul and fail to be converted. Paul was such gifted. He had such anointing that his anointing was contagious. He was such gifted. Anointing that was contagious because his life was all about Jesus. That's why he says, do not let anyone look down on you because you are young, but be an example for believers in your speech, in your conduct, and the love and faith and in purity. So he instituted him as the bishop of Ephesus, and also Titus as the bishop of Crete. So that is Paul for you. Such an amazing, amazing man of God. We have so much to learn about him. We have so much to learn about him that we don't have enough time for it. And that is why St. John Chrysostom, whom Raymond loves so very much. Let me see my book. Let's go. St. John Chrysostom has a quotation here. St. John Chrysostom. I know Brother Raymond loves him so much. By the way, St. John Chrysostom, whenever he would be preaching, St. John Chrysostom, one of the doctors of the church, whenever he would be preaching, because of his love for St. Paul, Paul would come and appear on his right hand side. Paul would come and appear on his what? On his right hand side. And
be there and wait for
him. Somebody's microphone is on. You can mute it, somebody. So St. John Chrysostom, whenever he would be preaching the word of God, Paul would appear on his right hand side and begin to tell him what to say. Sometimes he would see him, sometimes he would not see him, but he would always tell him what to say. So he was inflamed with the love of Paul after reading the Pauline letters. Have you heard that? He was inflamed with the love of St. Paul after reading the Pauline letters. So how can I begin my devotion to St. Paul? How can I be inflamed with the love of St. Paul? The first thing to do is to make a prayer, to pray. Now that you have known something that you didn't know about St. Paul, number one is to pray, that you may fall in love with Paul. Then secondly, begin straight away to read his letters, and especially starting with the Acts of the Apostles, which gives a background. Then after that, you go to his letters proper. I tell you, whether you want or not, as you read his letters, your love for him will come. And not only that, your love for Jesus will grow. Because Paul is about Jesus. Paul is not about anybody else. Let us get this scripture now, actually. 1 Corinthians 2:2. So Paul is not about himself. It is about Jesus. 1 Corinthians 2:2. Are we still there? Well, I'm also speaking like poor people are going to doors and sleep and fall in their chairs, fall in their beds. 1 Corinthians 2:2. So see the nature of Paul. He says, For while I was with you, you Corinthians, you people in Corinth, when I was with you, I made up my mind to forget everything. That is the nature of Paul. He forgot everything. And only Jesus was his life. And only Jesus. His life was about Jesus alone. Alone. Actually, what happened? Let me tell you what happened. When Paul was led out from Mameta in prison, to being taken outside the walls of Rome to be executed, tradition tells us that when they cut off his head, when they cut off the head of Paul, many things happened. One thing that happened was this. Even before, when you know, Paul was such a man that whenever you'd come in touch with him, you would be transformed. You would fall in love with Jesus immediately. It did not take long for Paul to convert somebody. He would even convert you with his examples alone. Leave alone him talking. He would convert you with his examples. The way he lived his life in humility, in simplicity, in contentment, in patience, endurance. He lived a life that, like you saw the life of Saint Francis of Assisi, whom they call another Christ, Saint Francis of Assisi. And actually, Saint Francis of Assisi was a very zealous imitator of Paul. He loved Paul so much, and he tried to imitate Paul. In the end, he even, I think, superseded Paul in imitation of Christ. That's why he's called another Christ. So what happened? When Paul was put in prison and he was assigned jailers, go take care of him, the prison wardens and all, he would convert all of them to the extent that they ran out of jailers and they left him alone. And he stayed in the prison and started writing letters. People would even visit him and go back. But he stayed, he became obedient. You know, he was such an obedient man. That's why he says, obey your leaders. Romans 13, obey even your civil leaders. Let's get it. Romans 13. So St. Paul, he was left alone in the prison. He didn't need anybody to confine him, to say, don't do this, don't that, don't escape. He knew he was in prison for a purpose. He knew he was in prison for a purpose, that even when he converted all the jailers, all the prison wardens, they left him alone and he started writing the letters from the prison. So Romans 13 from verse 1. So he even obeyed the law of the civil law. That's why he says, everyone must obey the state authorities. Some of you, as you are here, you don't obey the state authorities. Amen. You rebuke every minister. You gossip about ministers. You abuse them. You don't respect them. The political leaders in your home area. Paul says everyone must obey the state authorities, because no authority exists without God's permission, and the existing authorities have been put there by God. Whoever opposes the existing authority opposes God, what God has ordered. And anyone who does so will bring judgment on himself. For the rulers are not to be feared by those who do good. That's when you do good, Paul says, when you do good, you don't need to fear the rulers. When you do good, you don't need to fear police. When you do good, you don't need to fear them. But those who do evil, would you like to be an afraid of those in authority? Then do what is good, and then they will praise. Then we will praise you. So as I end this discussion, Paul is led out of the prison on the day of what? Of martyrdom. And halfway the journey from the prison to the place of martyrdom, half of the people who are accompanying him, the jailers or the wardens, were converted halfway. And then the rest went on until they got the place where he was executed. And when they cut off his trunk, because he was beheaded, they cut off his trunk, his head. When they cut off his head, instead of blood coming out, tradition tells us something like a white substance came out, and it sprinkled on them, on many soldiers, the Roman soldiers who were executing him. And whoever it touched felt the powerful grace of conversion, and they knelt down, they worshiped the Lord, confessed their sins, and proclaimed the faith of Paul. Can you imagine that even in death, he converted people? Not only that, when they cut off his head, tradition tells us that when they cut off his head, it bounced, it knocked down and started bouncing like a balloon, like a ball. And the moment it would hit the ground, it would say, Jesus. And the moment it would say, Jesus, the moment it would hit the ground, it would say, Jesus, and the fountain would come out. Then it hit the ground the second time, Jesus, fountain came out. The third time, Jesus, fountain came out. That's why the place is called the Three Fountains. And they have built a chapel there. When you go there, you can see the place of the Three Fountains. That is Paul for you. And as I close my session right now, I want to listen from you. Number one, maybe I can sample like five people. What has touched you about St. Paul as we discussed about him tonight? And secondly, what is your best Pauline scripture? What is your best Pauline scripture? You can raise your hands and you can sample many of you. Thereafter that, we shall have tonight with the Lady of Sorrows. I'm sorry, I may not have talked about everything because Paul is inexhaustible. He needs series and days and months. Maybe you shall get another time to talk about him more. Please raise your hands. What is your best Pauline scripture? Do you have any Pauline scripture? Like mine is Romans 8:28. Maybe Vivian can give it to us. Romans 8:28. That is my best scripture in the Roman theology. In all the scriptures of St. Paul. I have many of them that I love crazy, but the best of them is Romans 8:28. And it has been my status message, my message on the status ever since I joined social media 8 years ago, I think. 8 years. Or 7 years ago, it has never changed on my WhatsApp status, where you write something, a message down there. It has been this. We know that in all things, God works for good with those who love him, those whom he has called according to his purpose. In everything, as long as you love God, he will mean good for you. Even if bad things come, even if misfortunes come, setbacks come, you lose your father, you lose your job, you are, I don't know, whatever. You have an accident, you get sick, you lose whatever. St. Paul says, we know that as long as you are a lover of God, he means good for you in everything. And he's able to turn it around for your good. I love this scripture so, so much. So I want to know from you, before we come to the rosary, tonight to the Lady of Sorrows, I want to know from you, what is your best Pauline scripture and why? Please raise your hands because this is not a dormant class. Is it a dormant class, really? Raise your hand, chap, 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 because of time, chap, chap. Or you are going in the Bible to check now. If you are going in the Bible to check now, then you don't have it. If you are going in the Bible to check now, then you don't have it. Just surrender and say, Paul, please help me. But those who have, please share. Share and we finish this. Yes, Fiona Adikini. Number one, what have you learned? And you summarize it in a few seconds. Secondly, what is your best Pauline scripture?
What I've learned is the passion that Paul had in his preaching, and in a way I can see that same. I can see and also feel that same passion in the way you have talked to us today.
I think that is not a demo via Paul in the soul.
No, but that's the truth.
Okay. Okay, tell us your best Paul in scripture.
My best is Philippians 4:13.
And they can give it to us on the screen. Evelyn, Philippians 4:13. That is also one of my best. Evelyn, Philippians 4:13. One of my best. Oh my God. Yes, what does it say, Fiona, as they display it? What does it say?
I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Amen. I can do all things, St. Paul says. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. How does it talk to you, Fiona? In just 30 seconds?
Most times when I feel things are hard, when I feel like giving up, it's sort of framed somewhere.
It becomes your reference when you feel you are giving up. It's always your reference. Thank you so very much, Fiona. I know you are also a zealous lover of Paul. Okay, somebody else? You people, you ask Stefan, nobody wants to, has? Apart from Fiona Dikini? Okay, Joanna Iwaziwe. Yes, Joan. What have you learned today? And what is your best Pauline scripture and why?
My best Pauline scripture is Philippians 4, 6, 7.
Oh, I love that so much as well. Philippians chapter 4, what does it say? Okay, they can help you understand it.
Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God.
Even and the peace of God,
which transcends all understanding, will guard your heart and your minds in Jesus Christ.
Amen. And how does it talk to you, in short? If Evelyn, please display.
Verse 6, which says you should not be anxious about anything. Every time I'm worried about something, like maybe how will this one go? How will I get to this? How will I go through this? I know that my God always knows what he has in the plan for me, and he will always put everything together. And so you just pray and have hope that all shall be well.
Wow. Has it ever helped you in one situation where you are going through so much pain, so much trouble, and you referred to it and you got a breakthrough? Evelyn, highlight for us verse 7 as well. Thank you.
Yes, it has always worked for me. Wow. So many situations. And then even number 7.
There is one situation, if you remember one situation.
Brother Morris, there are so many.
Okay, thank you so much. Let's give opportunity to somebody else. Evelyn Amato. Evelyn Amato?
Yes, please.
Yes.
One thing I've learned from Paul today, even though he was not a follower, he had a great passion of Christ. He had a great faith that whatever comes out from his mouth will actually come to be fulfilled.
Thank you so very much.
And my best first of Pauline is Philippians 4:13. Yeah.
Philippians 4:13.
I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Thank you so very much, Christine. You are in Abu Dhabi, I think. You are a Kenyan, but working in the Middle East. Thank you so much for following our ministry. And may the Lord bless you. Joan Kalagala, if she's the last one, I don't see any more hands. Joan Kalagala, what have you learned today, and what's your best Pauline scripture, and why?
What I've learned today is to give my all for Christ, because when you were sharing, you talked about how much Paul had given. Like, he gave his all. He exhausted himself. I don't know the best way to put it, but like his life was for Christ. So what I've learned is that I should try my level best to give my all. And my best scripture is Philippians chapter 4, verses 19 to 20.
That one most people have it because they are praying for financial breakthrough. Okay, tell us, why do you love Philippians 4:19?
Okay, Philippians 4:19, much as it talks about financial breakthrough, I also use it for other kinds of breakthrough. Like, oh, wow. Where I would rest well. For example, if I'm not feeling well, like if my health is poor, I'll put health where there is wealth. If I've run out of ideas, I'll put ideas. So for me, that verse works so well for me because I see many things in it.
Thank you so very much, Joan Kalagara, for that. Most people love Philippians 4:19, I know that. Okay, thank you. And Flavia? Flavia? And then Irina Sasra, and then Dibia Deo.
Mine is, I started late though, but...
Before you go to yours, what have you learned today that has touched you to take home?
What I've learned is to have faith and hope in the Lord. Okay. In whatever sufferings that we go through, we should always have faith and hope. And I got this from Romans chapter 8:18.
Thank you. Okay. Yes. And what's your best scripture, Pauline scripture, if it's there?
Scripture? Romans 8:18 is what.
But you learned it today. You learned it today, right? You learned it today?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Yes. At least you have got that one. So thank you so very much, Flavium. God bless you.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. And many of you are not raising your hands because you don't have them. Many of you are not raising your hands because you don't have them. So at least that's a challenge. So next time when we have a session like this, I believe you even have many. I pray for you, surely, because you need them. Okay. Irina Sasira, Dibia Deho, Nasrum Heren.
Okay, good evening, brethren. My favorite one, I think the first scripture I got from the epistles of St. Paul, the one is the Romans 8:28. I love that one that talks about, that they had shared it, that talks about that everything works, God works everything for the good for those that he loves and those that are called according to his purpose. To me, what it tells me is that whatever things are going your way, if it is the plan of God for your life, even if there are very many obstacles to it, God will always find a way to fulfill his purpose in your life, whether it is bad or good. And I usually relate it to the Joseph, the son of Jacob, Israel, when the brothers, you know, decided to send him in Egypt, thinking that they were shattering and killing his dreams. But again, it was through him that they were saved. Then another scripture that I was challenged to go back and see where it lies, because I usually have the wordings in my head, not that I don't know the scriptures, is Colossians 3, verse 23 and 24, that in whatever you do, irrespective
of your position, can be displayed for us. It can be displayed for us, Evelyn. Colossians 3,
yeah.
23.
It talks about that whatever you do, put your heart into it, put love, and do every work you do as if you're doing it for the Lord, not for human beings.
And verse 24 as well. Verse 24, yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah, and I've always related this one to the kind of work I do. And I'm like, Irene, imagine this kind of work was an assignment by God. Do you think God would really be pleased with you? And this verse hits me all the time. Every time I tend to waste or try to do something off work during work hours, I'm like, really, Irene, do you think Jesus is happy with you if this is Jesus's work? Then another scripture.
That's so good, Irene. That is so good. That's so good of you.
Yeah. Then another scripture that I like is around, I think it was in 1 Corinthians, around chapter 6, verse something. It talks about like everything is lawful, but not everything is beneficial for you. And
that is That is 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. Should be verse 12.
Yes. So that scripture also, it clicked in my mind. You know, when you finish campus, you get
even
work.
You can give it to us, 1 Corinthians and chapter then, 6, verse 12.
And then you're excited about doing everything because everyone is doing it. Everyone is going partying. Everyone is coming home midnight. I mean, it is good life. You can enjoy everything. But know that everything that is out there is very beneficial or it is for your good, much as it's okay, but you need to choose what is best for you. Choose how to spend your time. Do you want to spend time partying or you want to spend your time building yourself and getting, you know, to know certain things that you would actually never get to know. So I also love that scripture. And of course, like I had said, I remember I commented on one of your statuses when you posted. I was like, oh, this man really, like, he really wrote almost half of the New Testament. And I'm like, what were the other apostles doing? I mean, like the other 12 of them. After, you know, I'm like, this guy did much more than any of the apostles who were actually with Jesus. And in my mind, I'm like, we need to get the spirit of the apostles because in our humanly speaking, if, for example, someone comes after you, I will relate this one to people who are already for working class. Imagine you've been with the master Jesus, you know everything that he did, you saw the miracles, you had the chance of touching him, but then now comes this other person afterwards after you, and then he does extra things than you've ever done. Most of us humans, I'm really sorry to say, person, I would first feel bad or jealous. I'm like, how could you? But then look at the apostles, and it really taught me, like, you know, it doesn't matter at what time you enter to do something, as long as a person is contributing to what you're doing, feel good for that person. So humanly speaking, that was really a challenge, you know, like, oh, this guy wrote almost like, were they 14 books or 17, 14, something like
14 out of 27 on the New Testament.
Yes, now you can imagine, at least in my mind, at least each apostle, the 12 of them, at least they would have been able to write a book, each one of them, but you see what this guy did. So, and they were not against, because Christ said that whoever is for me is not against me. Whoever does not gather with me really does scatter. So this one should really teach us as people who have been, you know, working. For example, you have like 10 years of experience. They bring a junior to you, then the junior tops you. You know, he delivers too much. Most people can even poison you, bewitch you, but you know, this one shouldn't work. We should emulate the apostles and then what St. Paul brought for them. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sister Irene. That's so wonderful. You are a lover of Paul, and like, as I can see the way you are quoting him, maybe next time we should give you a St. Paul memorial lecture. Okay, Dibia Deo, Nasiru Mheren, and then lastly, Florence Munduru.
Thank you, Brother Morris. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Allow me start with what I have learned today. Of course, I should say it's not that new, but with greater emphasis, it has added on to what I already knew. I'm getting to know more about listening and accepting God's call selflessly, irrespective of circumstances, just like St. Paul did. And second, if I go to my favorite scripture from St. Paul, I think I should admit that I learned about it today, and that is 1 Timothy 4:12.
Okay.
This has always been happening in my life. It's unfortunate that I could not relate my particular experience to a particular scripture in the Bible. I should testify of what has happened in my life about that.
Okay, you will testify on another day because time is not on our side, but at least it has related to your life and you feel you are encouraged by that scripture, right?
Exactly. So much.
Okay, thank you so much, brother. We shall have another opportunity you would share with us your testimony. Okay, thank you. God bless you. Helen, and lastly, Florence.
Thank you, Brother Morris. What I have learned today, when we look at Philip's Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 to 7, and 1 Timothy chapter 4 to 12, we come up with a conclusion that what happens in life, what everything that happens in life comes with a reason. Everything we experience in life.
Yes, Helen? Yes, Helen, we have lost you. Oh, sorry. So he's connecting both Philippians 4, 6 to 7 and 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, how they are connected. Yes? Okay. Thank you. We shall have you on another day. And lastly, Florence Muduru, you had spoken already, but let's give you another chance to speak. Yes, Florence, lastly. Florence, you have anything? Okay, I think you don't have. Okay, let me read a few messages. Nava Maria, the way I don't want the session to end, I swear, St. Paul is amazing. Thank you. Kobusinje Barbara, St. Paul has given me the morale to read and meditate the word of God in the Bible. And Waso Deo, those interested in Pauline teachings, kindly check on YouTube for the precious Bible study recordings. Okay, so we have a Bible class. As OLSG family, we have a Bible school, actually, Bible school, not class, Bible school, and our classes are on every weekend, Saturday and Sunday. In case you need more, you can get in touch with Twinamas Coach Julian or Evelyn, and they will lead you to the Bible school, and you shall get to know more about this. So thank you so very much. Let me just make a prayer with you and together and for you and close our session. And I will take a prayer from this book. A prayer from this book, A Month with St. Paul. A Month with St. Paul. So it's a prayer that for our needs, I will take it and somewhere I will give you a moment to ask St. Paul about anything. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. O Holy Apostle, with your teachings and with your charity, you taught the entire world, look kindly upon us, your children, especially this OLSG family. People, keep your microphones mute. We expect everything from your prayers to the Divine Master and to Mary, Queen of the Apostles. Grant, O Doctor of the Gentiles, that we may live by faith, save ourselves by hope, and that charity alone may reign in us. Obtain for us, O vessel of election, dear Saint Paul, docile correspondence to the divine grace, so that it may remain unfruitful, or so that it may not remain unfruitful in us. Grant, O dear Saint Paul, that we may ever better know you, love you, and imitate you, that we may be living members of the Church of Christ, the mystical body of Jesus Christ. Raise up, O St. Paul, many holy apostles. May the warm breath of true charity permeate the entire world. Grant that all may know and glorify God and the Divine Master, the Word, the Truth, and Life. And dear Lord Jesus, you know we have no faith in our own powers. In your mercy, grant that we may be defended against all adversary through the powerful intercession of St. Paul, our teacher. And to you, dear St. Paul, whom we have been celebrating today on the feast of your conversion, here are our prayer requests. If you so wish, present them to Jesus Christ, our Lord. And there you can mention your petition to St. Paul, and I know she's going to answer many of you so that she can raise your devotion for him. St. Paul, oh dear St. Paul, you have always been there for me many times, and you have always been there for your faithful sons and daughters. And your children are now praying and offering to you their petitions. You have just told us, St. Paul, in Philippians, in one of your letters, Philippians 4, 6 to 7, that we shouldn't be anxious about anything. But in all our prayers, we should make our requests known to God. Now we do this, St. Paul, through you. We refuse anxiety. We repent of our anxiety we have been having, and through you, dear St. Paul, we mention our petitions to Jesus. Saint Paul, thank you for listening to our prayers, and we believe you have received them, and you will present them to Jesus our Lord. Amen. Saint Paul, pray for us. Saint Paul, pray for us. Saint Paul, pray for us. And we pray for Archbishop Paul Semogere, through the intercession of Saint Paul, that he will do great work in this archdiocese that has been given to him. Saint Paul, pray for Archbishop. Saint Paul, pray for Archbishop Paul Semogere. Saint Paul, pray for Archbishop Paul Semogere. Even the Archbishop of Marara, the former Archbishop, is also called Paul Bachenga. Pray for the church. Pray for everybody in the church, that we may all have the fire of the love of Jesus like you had. We may all imitate Jesus like you imitated him, or dear Saint Paul. May your children who have been part of this program, those who have left, those who are here still, and those who are going to watch the videos, may they fall in love with their devotion and come to Jesus through you, because you have told us in 1 Corinthians 11:1 that we should imitate you as you imitate Christ. And give them the grace to fall in love with Scripture. And as they read the Scripture, may they feel their hearts burning with fire. May they have love for the Scripture. And may Scripture never bore them from today. And through you, may they find perfect union with the Immaculate Heart of Mary and the Sacred Heart of Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So thank you so very much. I'm sorry for altering the program. That was the Holy Spirit. I couldn't do otherwise. I had to follow the voice of the Holy Spirit. Thank you so very much. And we thank God for Evelyn, whose time I have taken. And I know she's not feeling bad about it. She's a lady led by the Holy Spirit. And now I shall hand over to Evelyn for our next session. The Litany of the Holy Name of Jesus, and then the Tonight with the Lady of Sorrows. And I want to say good night to you, and I wish you well, because my battery is running down right now. I have to shut off the computer, and maybe I will be joining you by my phone. Thank you very much. May St. Paul stay close to you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Praise God, brothers and sisters. The Lord is good all the time, and all the time the Lord is good, and that's his nature. Well, join me, thank Brother Maurice so very much for the gift of today and for having led us in the session about the conversion of St. Paul. We have learned a lot since 8 p.m. till now, and I do believe that there must be something that has touched you. Praise God. So bless the Lord so very much for the gift of Brother Maurice. Thank you, Brother Maurice, for allowing to be used by the Holy Spirit and making us fall in love with St. Paul. May God bless you, continue to use you. Amen, amen, amen. And to all of us who have been here, who are still here, I can see the numbers are going down. Thank you so much for being here. We bless the Lord for you. We cannot take you for granted, and pray for a special blessing to be upon you for the time you have spent here learning the word of God. The word of God, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, the word of God is like a double-edged sword. It cuts where you cannot cut, where the soul is, where the spirit and soul meet. So as you listen to the word of God, I do believe that God was touching you, was transforming your life, and doing mighty things. That is my faith. I don't know where your faith is, but I do believe that for all of us. Praise God. And so, brothers and sisters, this is our moment to pray the Litany of the Holy Name of Jesus. Those of you who have prayed with us for the very first time, we had this long session because today we celebrate the conversion of St. Paul. And Brother Maurice is one of the people who loves St. Paul so much, who was inspired by St. Paul to live a life he is living. So, can't let that day escape. And that is why it has been like this. But every day, we begin the chaplet of St. Michael, pray the rosary, the Litany of the Holy Name of Jesus, and a night with Our Lady, and we are done. So, brothers and sisters, we apologize for the delay, but we do believe that it was for the glory of God. So let's take the litany, since this whole month is dedicated to the Holy Name of Jesus. And immediately after that, we shall pray the Rosary of Seven Sorrows, and we call it a night. Thank you so much. May God bless you. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, hear us. Christ, graciously hear us. God, the Father of heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity, one God, have mercy on us. Jesus, Son of the living God, have mercy on us. Jesus, Splendor of the Father, have mercy on us. Jesus, Brightness of eternal light, have mercy on us. Jesus, King of glory, have mercy on us. Jesus, Son of justice, have mercy on us. Jesus, Son of the Virgin Mary, have mercy on us. Jesus, most amiable, have mercy on us. Jesus, most admirable, have mercy on us. Jesus, the mighty God, have mercy on us. Jesus, Father of the world to come, have mercy on us. Jesus, angel of the great council, have mercy on us. Jesus, most powerful, have mercy on us. Jesus, most patient, have mercy on us. Jesus, most obedient, have mercy on us. Jesus, meek and humble of heart, have mercy on us. Jesus, lover of chastity, have mercy on us. Jesus, our lover, have mercy on us. Jesus, God of peace, have mercy on us. Jesus, author of life, have mercy on us. Jesus, model of virtues, have mercy on us. Jesus, zealous for souls, have mercy on us. Jesus, our God, have mercy on us. Jesus, our refuge, have mercy on us. Jesus, Father of the poor, have mercy on us. Jesus, treasure of the faithful, have mercy on us. Jesus, good shepherd, have mercy on us. Jesus, true light, have mercy on us. Jesus, eternal wisdom, have mercy on us. Jesus, infinite goodness, have mercy on us. Jesus, our way and our life, have mercy on us. Jesus, joy of the angels, have mercy on us. Jesus, King of the patriarchs, have mercy on us. Jesus, Master of the apostles, have mercy on us. Jesus, Teacher of the evangelists, have mercy on us. Jesus, Strength of matters, have mercy on us. Jesus, Light of confessors, have mercy on us. Jesus, Purity of virgins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Crown of all saints, have mercy on us. Be merciful, spare us, O Jesus. Be merciful, graciously spare us, O Jesus. From all evil, deliver us, O Jesus. From all sin, deliver us, O Jesus. From your wrath, deliver us, O Jesus. From the snares of the devil, deliver us, O Jesus. From the spirit of fornication,
deliver us, O Jesus.
From everlasting death,
deliver us, O Jesus.
From the neglect of your inspirations,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through the mystery of your holy incarnation,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your nativity,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your infancy,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your most divine life,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your labors,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your agony and passion,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your cross and dereliction,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your sufferings,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your death and burial,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your resurrection,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your ascension,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your institution of the most holy Eucharist,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your joys,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Through your glory,
deliver us, O Jesus.
Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, spare us, O Jesus. Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, graciously hear us, O Jesus. Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us, O Jesus. Jesus, hear us. Jesus, graciously hear us. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have said, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened to you. Mercifully attend to our supplications and grant us the grace of your most divine love, that we have loved you with all our hearts and in all our words and actions, and never cease to praise you. Make us, O Lord, to have perpetual fear and love of your holy name. For you never fail to govern those whom you establish in your love. You who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Jesus, we thank you so much for the gift of our lives. And we know that with you, we can do it. We can make it. In you, we move, we live, and have our being. We thank you. I'm going to ask you to help us believe in you, trust in you in all walks of life. Amen. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, brothers and sisters, and welcome back from the Litany of the Holy Name of Jesus. Straight away, we shall have a night with Our Lady. and we are going to pray the rosary of seven sorrows. But we will not have meditation, but we shall pray from our hearts, deep within our hearts. So as we read any sword, relate it to your life, connect yourself to the prayer so that it's not just a matter of reading. So it will be meditation from your side as we read the meditations, that you put your heart to the sword, to the Hail Mary, because Hail Mary is such a beautiful prayer that Mother Mary loves more than anything. So if we see these Hail Marys with faith, united with all our petitions, sorry about that, a miracle of electricity leaving our home is on. Praise God. So we shall pray with faith. So I request you to humble ourselves and we begin the Rosary of Seven Sorrows straight away. I have an amazing team right here. So they will help us take some of the swords. Allow me do that so that we are a bit more organized, since I know some of you want to run away. Praise God. So let's begin the Rosary. Doreen, are you able to share the Rosary? Thank you so much. Okay. Let's begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My God, I offer you this Rosary for your glory. I want to honor your Holy Mother, the Blessed Virgin, by meditating upon and sharing in her suffering. Oh, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, trusting in your infinite love, I turn to you for forgiveness and mercy. I am truly sorry for the pains you suffered in your most bitter passion because of my sins, for love of you and before your holy presence. I utterly renounce and forsake all the sins of my whole life. I ask pardon of you with all my heart. I firmly resolve to amend my life and would rather die than offend you again. Oh, Blessed Virgin Mary, you are our tender mother and the refuge of sinners. I run to you with confidence and love. Hide me under your mantle of love and protection. As I meditate upon the swords of sorrow that pierced your immaculate heart, obtain for me the forgiveness of my sins and the grace to live a life of heroic holiness. Oh, Blessed Mother, I unite my heart to yours, and I offer this rosary for priests, for their growth in holiness, obedience to the magisterium, boldness in the proclamation of the gospel, and a profound love for the people of God. May all priests humbly lead the souls entrusted to their care into an intimate relationship with the Lord. We also pray for the following particular intentions. Dear Mother of God, in this moment, as we are here before you in this Rosary of Seven Sorrows, we unite our hearts to yours. We unite our sorrows and joys to your sorrowful and immaculate heart. Look at us, O dear Mother. We need you. We need you. We need your consolation. We need your teaching. We need your love. We need your presence where we are right now. You are present in the life of St. Paul, and he truly converted. We to believe that if you are with us, we can never be the same people that we have been. Mother, we ask you in this rosary, come and console us. Come and be with us. Come and teach us. Come and pray for us to change our lives for the glory of God. Mother, there are so many sorrows around our lives, and there are also joys around our lives. But we ask you that as we pray this rosary, may you help us understand that God loves us no matter what, no matter what is going on in our lives. Mother of God, be a mother to each one of us. You know their petitions of body, spirit, and soul. Please be close to them. Console them, those on YouTube and Zoom, and hear them all across our platforms. Dear Mother, may you touch your children and hear their prayers. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and enkindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. The first sword of sorrow. Simeon announces the suffering destiny of Jesus. O mother of sorrows, how deeply your heart was pierced with sorrow when Simeon announced that Jesus, your beloved child, was to be a sign that would be rejected. Your heart knew that he was to be the suffering Messiah the prophets had foretold, the man of sorrows who would carry all our sins and heal us by his wounds. Through this bitter sorrow, obtain for us the grace never to reject Jesus or refuse him anything. Help us to completely surrender our lives to him and to live according to his most holy will in everything. Amen. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Holy Mother, hear my prayers, and renew in my heart each wound of Jesus, my Savior. Amen. We shall have Sister Daphne, naturally leading us through the second sword of sorrow.
The second sword of sorrow. Mary escapes into Egypt with Jesus and Joseph. Mother of sorrow, Mother of sorrows, what pain filled your heart as you fled your home and country, knowing that the tyrant Herod was intent on murdering your little child, whom you loved above all else. The hardships of travel, the long journey, and life as a refugee was nothing compared to the torment of such demonic malice directed toward Jesus. Through this bitter sword of sorrow, obtain for us the grace never to risk the life of Jesus in our souls through deliberate sin. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Holy Mother,
hear my prayers and renew in my heart each wound of Jesus, my Savior. Amen.
We shall have Sister Restikov Jenny taking us through the third sword of sorrow.
Mary seeks Jesus lost in Jerusalem. Oh, Mother of Sorrows, what
great. I saw the guys in our prayer group. Eh? I say Monty Finger is the chairperson of Ghana Nightlife Association.
The third sword of sorrow. Mary seeks Jesus lost in Jerusalem. Oh, Mother of Sorrows, what grief filled your heart as you and Joseph searched desperately for Jesus when you could not find him among your relatives and friends, returning home from Jerusalem? When your son replied that he must be about his father's business, you accepted that he had begun the mission that would lead to his sacrificial death. The sorrow of those 3 days of separation prepared you for the 3 days of suffering you endured while his body lay lifeless in the tomb. Through this bitter sword of sorrow, obtain for us the grace to accept the ways of divine providence, even when we do not understand them. Amen.
Kitafari mugulu erinyere kitibo bwakabaka obuje byaga bikorewe ku nsinga bikorewa mugulu
otwemere afe abunaku otsonywe bibya fe nafu otsonywa tukorobi totwa mukeme bwana itukore mubi amina
mirembe maria ojude nema omukamali nawe wawebwa omukisamba kazi bonane ezo mwana wenda ene wa mukisa
maria mtuki vina katonda tsabye fa bononi Kakane mkasera kokufa kwa fe, amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamali nawe, wawebwa mukisamba kazi bona, neyezo mwana wenda ene wa mukisa.
Maria mtukirifnina katondo tisabye favononi, kakane mkasera kokufa kwa fe, amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamali nawe, wawebwa mukisamba kazi bona, neyezo mwana wenda ene wa mukisa.
Maria mtukirifnina katondo tisabire fabononi, kakane mkasera kokufa kwa fe, amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamali nawe, wawebwa mukisa mubakazi bona, neyezo mwana wenda ene wa mukisa.
Maria mtukirifnina katondo tisabire fabononi, kakane mkasera kokufa kwa fe, amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamali nawe, wawebwa mukisa mubakazi bona, neyezo mwana wenda ene wa mukisa.
Maria mtukirifnina katondo tisabire fabononi, kakane mkasera kokufa kwa fe, amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamali nawe, wawebwa mukisa mubakazi bona, neyezo mwana wenda ene wa mukisa.
Maria mtukirifnina katondo tisabire fabononi, kakane mkasera kokufa kwa fe, amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamali nawe, wawebwa mukisa mubakazi bona, neyezo mwana wenda ene wa mukisa.
Maria mtukirifnina katondo tisabire fabononi, kakane mkasera kufa kwa fe, amina.
Holy Mother,
hear my prayers and renew in my heart each wound of Jesus, my Savior. Amen.
We shall have our sister Claire Tukwase leading us through the fourth sword of sorrow.
The fourth sword of sorrow. Mary meets Jesus as he carries his cross to Calvary. Oh, Mother of Sorrows, how it must have wounded your tender maternal heart to see your beloved son Jesus carrying his cross to Calvary, the place of execution. How it must have pained you to see him so bloodied, beaten, and reviled as he strained to fulfill his deepest desire to give his life as a ransom for us. Through this bitter sword of sorrow, obtain for us the grace to deny ourselves, pick up our crosses, and follow Jesus with perseverance and love. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Continue to pray for the grace of perseverance amidst all circumstances. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Holy Mother, hear my prayers, and renew in my heart each wound of Jesus, my Savior. Amen.
The fifth sword of sorrow. Mary stands near the cross of her son Jesus. O Mother of Sorrows, here the prophecy of Simeon comes to its ultimate fulfillment. The sword of sorrow impels your heart as you stand beneath the cross of your son. Crucified spiritually with your crucified son, you offered him to the Father and united yourself completely to his self-offering and sacrificial death. We simply cannot fathom the pain of your offering or the depth of love that inspired it. Through this bitter sword of sorrow, obtain for us the grace to unite all our sufferings to our crucified Lord with unselfish generosity and love. Amen. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
I'm getting a message of a quickening. There is going to be a quickening. I don't know what plans we've been having, but certain things are going to happen earlier than we expected, just by the intercession of our Blessed Mother. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Holy Mother,
hear my prayers, and renew in my heart each wound of Jesus, my Savior. Amen.
The sixth sword of sorrow. Mary receives into her arms the body of Jesus, taken down from the cross. O Mother of Sorrows, your heart was drowned in grief as you embraced the lifeless corpse of your son. He who was your very life was now dead. Your light in this life was extinguished. Yet you accepted this sorrow with love, knowing that it was all part of the Father's plan of salvation. Through this bitter sword of sorrow, obtain for us the grace to accept with patience and love the sorrows that befall us in this veil of tears. Firmly believing that God works all things to the good for those who love him. Amen. Kitaffe ali mu ggulu, erinnya lyo litiibwe, obwakabaka bujje, byagala bikolebwe ku nsi nga bikolebwa mu ggulu.
Otuwe emmere yaffe ya buli lunaku, otusonyiwe ebibi byaffe, nga naffe tusonyiwa abatukola obubi, totutwala mu kukemebwa, naye tulokole mu bubi. Amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema, Omukama ali naawe, waweebwa omukisa mubakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endiga ni wa mukisa.
Maria omutuukirivu, nnyina wa Katonda, otusabye efe abonoonyi, kaakano mu kaseera k'okufa kwaffe. Amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema, Omukama ali naawe, waweebwa omukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endiga ni wa mukisa.
Maria omutuukirivu, nnyina wa Katonda, otusabye efe abonoonyi, kaakano mu kaseera k'okufa kwaffe. Amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema, Omukama ali naawe, waweebwa omukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endiga ni wa mukisa.
Maria omutuukirivu, nnyina wa Katonda, otusabye efe abonoonyi, kaakano mu kaseera k'okufa kwaffe. Amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema, Omukama ali naawe, waweebwa omukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endiga ni wa mukisa.
Maria omutuukirivu, nnyina wa Katonda, otusabye efe abonoonyi, kaakano mu kaseera k'okufa kwaffe. Amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojjudde ennema, Omukama ali naawe, waweebwa omukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endiga ni wa mukisa.
Maria omutuukirivu, nnyina wa Katonda, otusabye efe abonoonyi,
kakane mkasera kokufa kwafe. Amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamari nawe. Wawebwe mukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endo ine wa mukisa.
Maria mchukirivu nyina Katonda, tusabire fa bononyi. Kakane mkasera kokufa kwafe. Amina.
Mirembe Maria, ojude nema, omukamari nawe. Wawebwe mukisa mu bakazi bonna, ne Yesu omwana w'endo ine wa mukisa.
Maria mchukirivu nyina Katonda, tusabire fa bononyi. Kakane mkasera kokufa kwafe. Amina.
Holy Mother, hear my prayers and renew in my heart each wound of Jesus my Savior. Amen.
The seventh sword of sorrow. Mary helps place the body of Jesus in the tomb. O Mother of sorrows, who could express the cruel anguish of this moment? The same child that you once wrapped in swaddling clothes amidst unspeakable joy, you now wrap silently in his burial shroud. Your tears mingle with the blood and dirt that covers his broken body. But even in this moment, your trust in his promise did not die. Your mourning was not without hope, for you knew that he would rise again from this grave just as he promised. Through this bitter sword of sorrow, obtain for us the grace to believe with unshakable hope in the victory of our Lord, even in the darkest moments of our lives. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as Mother Mary wraps the body of Jesus, it's such a terrible moment. What are you wrapping in your life? What do you seem to feel is dead? Have you lost hope? The other day, a woman told me, my husband has told me to pack and leave. He has married a richer woman than me. She is packing her bags to leave her marital home where she was married officially to go back to the village. She is wrapping something and she cannot wrap that with joy. I tell you, it is so sad. What are you wrapping in your life that you're looking at? As Mother Mary wraps the body of Jesus, she still remembers amid his tears, amid it all, that there is hope. God cannot lie. That was her hope. And she knew that surely God would never lose. She would never be a loser. And that hope kept her moving, kept her hoping up to when Jesus resurrected. My dear brothers and sisters, there could be something that you wrapped and thought that was the end. God closed the chapter. But I tell you, unless God says it is done, it cannot be done. It may be a year, it may be months, it could be weeks. But I tell you, if God hasn't declared it done, it is not done. If your doctors have said you're a gone case, we have never had such a patient, and you know what? For you, it's a gone case. I tell you, if God has not said it's done, it will not be done. You will not die. You will see a resurrection in your life. Brothers and sisters, I give you a moment to whisper to God through the intercession of Mother Mary. What have you wrapped? What have you written off and felt it is gone? It can never be yours. Is it the state of your family? Is it your well-being or body, spirit, and soul? Is it your body? Is it your career? Is it about your job? Is it about your marriage? Your child that you prayed for and they don't change? They're the last one in class? I tell you, God can still bring a resurrection in that moment. That is why we are saying, and let us believe with unshakable hope in the victory of our Lord, even in the darkest moments of our lives. It could be that you're in a dark moment right now, that even as they preach every day, you're saying, when will it happen? Brothers and sisters, may you introduce once more, as we come to the end of our rosary, those dark moments to Mother Mary and say, Mother, you went through this. Here I am too. It is the same. But I do not have faith. I have lost hope. Please give me hope. Increase my faith in God that I will win. So make a prayer. Mother Mary is listening. And I do believe she will not be comfortable. She will do something for you. So in a moment of silence with faith, tell Mother Mary, there is this dark moment of my life. I have wrapped it. I feel it is gone. But I know you can do something. You who did not lose hope, you can still pray for me so that I can see light at the end of the tunnel. So you just have a few minutes. Speak to Mother Mary. Like, she is in your house, and I do believe she is there. And tell her, where is your dark moment? What have you wrapped? What have you written off? She is telling you, my child, you're not alone. I am with you. God can still work out something in ways you cannot imagine, because he is not limited at all. Today could be your day when Mother Mary wants to visit you and wipe away your tears. So don't take this moment for granted. Speak to her. She is our mother, full of mercy. Mother, we pray that as your children lift their prayers to you, please look at them and hear them and do something. Second Peter chapter 3 verse 8 tells us that one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like one day before the Lord. So what you have thought to have taken long could be even worked on tonight as we pray, if you have faith. Yes.
So strong and brave, gentle mother, he's called up to trust wisdom, to trust God. You will trust God by the Father.
St. Paul tells us, in his book, A Month with St. Paul, I remember this now, that when Mother Mary takes care of a soul, its defects don't matter anymore. So if Mother Mary takes care of your petition, it won't matter the mistakes, because she is holy, she is pure, and her prayers are so perfect. So Mother, we ask you, take care of our souls. Take care of our prayers. Take care of our families. Take care of our neighbors. Take care of our friends. Take care of our nations. Take care of our relatives, our brothers and sisters, our friends, our relatives. Take care of everyone here right now, and everyone has been here since the beginning of this session at 8 p.m. Take care of those on YouTube. Take care of all those who have asked us to pray for them, who have sent their petitions. Mother of God, take care of their petitions. Take care of our petitions. We surrender to you. You're blessed among all women and men as well. Mother, more mercy. Mother, full of compassion. Hurry to our aid. We need you. We need you more than before, Mother. We need a miracle. We need to see the hand of God, and only you can do it. Mother, we lift our hands to you and ask you to pray for all your children tonight. Those who even don't have faith, pray for them. Those who feel they are so sinful and you can't hear them, hear them out, Mother, because you are the refuge of sinners. Thank you, Mother Mary. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit, to believe in that victory that we just meditated about. Gentle Mother, peaceful Dove, pray for us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with you. Blessed I am among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
There is someone who is praying for her baby, Isabel, who has headache and a high temperature. We lift that baby to Mother Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed I am among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed I am among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
We pray for all our petitions that we have mentioned of body, spirit, and soul. Mother, take care of all of them. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed I am among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed I am among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed I am among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Mother Mary, we give ourselves entirely to you. You are the queen with a crown in our lives. Take your place. Be a mother to each one of us. Wherever we are, take your place in our homes. Where there is chaos, bring order, Mother. Bring joy. You are the cause of our joy. Let all your children experience your joy as we come to the end of our rosary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Holy Mother, hear my prayers and renew in my heart each wound of Jesus, my Savior. Amen. And let's pray three Hail Marys in honor of the tears of our sorrowful Mother. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are among women, and blessed the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are among women, and bless the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are among women, and bless the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Closing prayers. Oh Mary, you truly became the queen of all matters. As these seven bitter swords of sorrow pierced your immaculate heart, by the merits of your tearful distress, obtain for us and for all sinners the graces of perfect contrition and conversion. Help us always, dear Mother, to imitate you by taking up our crosses and following Jesus with limitless love and generosity. Amen. Mary was conceived without sin and who suffered for us.
Pray for us.
Mary was conceived without sin and who suffered for us.
Pray for us.
Mary who was conceived without sin and who suffered for us.
Pray for us.
The Litany of Our Lady of Seven Sorrows. Lord have mercy on us.
Christ have mercy on us.
Lord have mercy on us. Christ hear us. Christ graciously hear us. God the Father of heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world,
have mercy on us.
God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy on us.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us. Holy Virgin of Virgins, pray for us. Mother of the Crucified, pray for us. Sorrowful Mother,
pray for us.
Mournful Mother,
pray for us.
Sighing Mother,
pray for us.
Afflicted Mother,
pray for us.
Forsaken Mother, pray for us. Desolate Mother, pray for us. Mother most sad, pray for us. Mother sit around with anguish, pray for us. Mother overwhelmed by grief,
pray for us.
Mother transfixed by a sword, pray for us. Mother crucified in your heart,
pray for us.
Mother bereaved of your son,
pray for us.
Sighing dove, pray for us. Mother of sorrows,
pray for us.
Mass of suffering,
pray for us.
Mirror of patience, pray for us. Rock of constancy,
pray for us.
Remedy in perplexity,
pray for us. Joy of the afflicted, pray for us. Ark of the desolate, pray for us. Refuge of the abandoned, pray for us. Shield of the oppressed, pray for us. Conqueror of the incredulous, pray for us. Solace of the wretched, pray for us. Medicine of the sick, pray for us. Help of the faint,
pray for us.
Strength of the weak, pray for us. Protectress of those who fight, pray for us. Haven of the shipwrecked, pray for us. Calmer of tempests,
pray for us.
Companion of the sorrowful, pray for us. Retreat of those who groan, pray for us. Terror of the treacherous, pray for us. Standard bearer of the martyrs, pray for us. Treasure of the faithful, pray for us. Light of confessors, pray for us. Pearl of virgins, pray for us. Comfort of widows, pray for us. Joy of all saints, pray for us. Queen of your servants, pray for us. Holy Mary, who alone are beyond compare, pray for us. Holy Mary, who alone are beyond compare,
pray for us.
Pray for us, most sorrowful virgin, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Let us pray. O God, in whose passion, according to the prophecy of Simeon, a sword of grief pierced through the most sweet soul of thy glorious blessed Virgin Mother Mary, grant that we, who celebrate the memory of our seven sorrows, we may obtain the happy effect of your passion, who lives and reigns, world without end. Amen. Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy, hail our life, our sweetness and our hope. To you do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. To you do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this veil of tears. Turn then, most gracious advocate, your eyes of mercy towards us. And after this, our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, and never was it known that anyone who fled your protection, implored your help, or sought your intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto you, O Virgin of Virgins, Mary, my mother. To you I come, before you I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word Incarnate, despise not our petitions, but in your mercy, hear and answer us. Amen. O sweet Mother Mary, as we come to the end of this session, we humbly ask you to continue taking care of us. We give you all our preoccupations. We give you all the programs we have for tomorrow and for the rest of the lives, for the rest of the days to come, Mother. We give you the programs we have, the retreats that are happening with Father Bashovala and the Catholic Charismatic Renewal, Squad of the Spirit, Divine Rwanda. They have a retreat tomorrow. We commit all sessions and the sessions we have tomorrow into your Immaculate Heart, Mother. Shield them from the evil one. May each and every activity we plan to do be fruitful and successful, Mother. We leave you all our worries and fears in your sorrowful and Immaculate Heart, because we know that at the end, the Immaculate Heart will triumph. Mother, may we triumph with you because you are our mother. And sweet Mother Mary, continue to keep all of us in your mantle of love and protection as we go to sleep and others begin their day, Mother. Keep us all close to your sorrowful and Immaculate Heart, and keep us in your mantle of love and protection. Amen. Thank you, Mother Mary. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen. Immaculate Heart of Mary, pray for us. Immaculate Heart of Mary, pray for us. Immaculate and Sorrowful Heart of Mary, pray for us. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy on us. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy on us. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy on us. Most Precious Blood of Jesus, cover us now and forever. Amen. Most Precious Blood of Jesus, cover us now and forever. Amen. And upon our families, Most Precious Blood of Jesus, cover our families now and forever. Amen. And upon all our preoccupations, whatever occupies us, whatever we plan to do, Most Precious Blood of Jesus, cover our preoccupations,
now and forever. Amen. And we have prayed, believing and trusting in the mightiest name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so very much, brothers and sisters, for being here, for sacrificing all this time and praying. We are just reminding you that you are a real blessing to God. You are that treasure that God looks at every time you come to pray. He bends his ear to listen to your prayer. And you're reminded of our program this Saturday of a day with Mother Mary in Munyonyo. So friends, we ask you to share this information so that we can all make it. We need to be there, brothers and sisters. So kindly share this information. And all of you have prayed with us for the very first time. This is Our Lady Star of the Gospel family. We pray every day from 8 to 10 p.m. The Living Rosary, Chaplet of St. Michael, the Rosary. It's either Seven Sorrows on Tuesday and Friday or the Ordinary Rosary that you know. And we accompany that with sharing, preaching the Word of God, testimonies. Woo! Awesome, 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 every day with God. So you are kindly requested to always log in. Those who have been here for the very first time, it's the same link, it never changes. And if you are surely to stay in touch, you can always send us your contacts. You can type them in the chat room and then we shall add you to our platforms. Thank you very much. May God bless you. We humbly request you to keep this ministry in prayer as we pray for you as well. But please, most important, we hope to see all of you this Saturday. It will be awesome to meet all of you. I mean, Mother Mary will be very excited to welcome you. And we have also Divine Mercy prayers every day in the Chaplet of Perpetual Help at 3 p.m. every day. So you can always log in if you are available and we pray together. I think Doreen is trying to share that. Yeah, that's it. Thank you very much for being here, surely. May God bless you more and more and more. We shall have a closing song that will end this session, but we continue to thank everyone who has made this success a success. Those who have led us from the beginning, Brother Deo, Brother Morris, we are so grateful to you, and we give thanks to God for you and ask the Lord to continue to reward you. And those who helped us, share the screen, share the link. May God bless you. Your reward is surely there. You are not working for free. God will repay you back. May God bless you all. Continue to fall in love with St. Paul and Mother Mary. So let's have a song that will close our session. Be blessed. Thank you.
clearly, my love.